Hello, and welcome to the first post-release episode of the Lincolncast. If you haven't listened to this before, this is not a family show. This is definitely explicit, and we earn our explicit tag. I'd also like to thank Bahloo for his appearance on today's show. He does have a couple of audio issues, so give him a break. It's his first time on. But I'd have to say that if you are offended by German jokes or Holocaust jokes or World War II jokes, then perhaps this episode is not for you because we maybe take it a little bit too far. Whatever. Fuck it, it's the Lincolncast. Hello, and welcome to the Leaky Cast. This is the Giant Bomb Community's Guild Wars 2 podcast for the week of August 31st. I'm your host, selfconfessedcynic, and joining me today is Noobarama.
Hi!
Dourin.
Hello.
Really, every week you say the same fucking thing, yeah, and it's
hello.
Just not.
Hello.
It's just,
I was
it's
doing
not
three
good
things
enough.
At once. I was doing three things.
But really, hello?
I realized my mic was muted on the stream.
I want something like noob. I want some powers, some emphasis, some energy.
That's what I'm paid for, man. Paid for.
Yeah.
Below minimum wage, mind you, if anyone's listening, I'm getting paid below minimum
wage. Looking at your efforts today, I don't think you deserve above minimum wage.
Oh, wow. Wow. Wow.
Also joining me today is Zumi Robin. How are you doing, Zumi Robin?
I love spotted dick.
You like, what? Oh, like the English.
He's British.
He what do you call it? It's not a pastry. It's not
it's
a pastry,
like a cake. It's a sponge cake.
It's a
yeah, it's like sponge cake with raisins. But, tastes nice.
Is it like the Christmas like fruit cake thing stuff? That stuff?
No, it's all year round. Like I have it especially.
No, I mean, like, does it have rum in it and Wednesdays. Stuff? Or is it just
rum?
Like,
no, it doesn't have rum. No,
it's not an alcoholic.
It's not an alcoholic
food.
Dick.
Yeah, it's just the one with spots on them. It's spotted.
Yeah, it's just you can get alcoholic dick, but it's not nice.
Wait, do you call it alcoholic dick, or is it alcoholic spotted dick?
Yeah,
or is it okay?
If you're at the store, you say you whisper, "Do you have any AD?" and they give it you in a brown bag.
Oh God.
And you open it, it's just filled with dust. You're like, this is what I wanted. This is not what I wanted at all. Also joining us today, he's being oddly silent, being really silent, is Sookee, a.k.a. Bahloo, a.k.a. Sookee. How are you doing?
Or Sookee.
Guten Tag. I'm doing fine. I'm great.
He's from Austria.
Wait, this guy's German. Right, I'm off. What? I'm off. I can't believe you did this. I can't believe you did this. Me and a German. Not happening.
Oh, man.
Oh, God. You can feel the racial tensions.
Yep.
Sookee, yep. How do you feel about the Nazis?
Wow! Wow! We're really doing this, aren't we? We are really doing this. I didn't think we'd actually be doing this.
Less than 5 minutes in, and Nazis have already gotten brought up.
Yep.
I wanted to drop it at the start because it's going to come out eventually.
No, it won't.
Like once you start hiling on the show, then yeah, it's better than that.
Tell me about Austria and the great nice forests in Austria.
That you
tell me about Auschwitz. Was it really as bad as everyone says?
Oh my God. Wow.
I'm pretty sure we're just getting everything out of the way.
What are we
doing? Everything out of the way right now.
Oh God.
I'm so glad this was accidentally on general discussion first.
Oh man.
Oh fuck. How you guys going? Sookee, what have you been doing this week?
I have been doing not much really. I've just been kind of hanging out, you know.
Wait,
just
for
hanging
people
it,
who don't know,
just
you, hanging you, you're new to the podcast. This is your, by the way, this is Sookee, the first episode of the podcast. What,
yes.
How did you get on here? How do you find out about Giant Bomb? How did you find out about the Guild Wars 2 Guild?
By the way, in the chat, we need to be turned up. Apparently,
well,
I have turned everybody up as high as they can go.
How is it just meeting a random person on Facebook and then being on their podcast?
Oh, it's absolutely fantastic. It's spectacular.
I cannot believe you added it into Facebook.
I wanted a German person on the podcast, so I typed in German.
it's basically that. Yeah, yeah.
And I guess we hadn't gone to Nazis yet. We've done North Koreans. We've definitely done the Chinese.
We have North Koreans. Sure we have people from Wales.
We've done the Chinese, haven't we?
We have a Welsh person on here.
From Wales.
From a Welshman on here. We have an Indian in Australia.
We've never had a Welshman on.
Well, yeah. Ben, our...
Zumi Ramen.
Zumi Ramen.
Welshman. Whoa, that's the real bomb.
He, no, he's Welsh, aren't you?
Are you fucking Welsh?
You like sheep.
I'm from Wales. No, I can't do a Welsh accent. Okay. No, okay. I'm from England. I'm from Manchester. You know,
I'm from England. Yeah. I'm from England, yeah. Not Wales.
the Industrial Revolution.
Oh, God.
It's light and geography's never been my strong point, so...
So you could be from Wales, but you just don't know.
Yeah, it could be. That's probably the case, yeah.
before I just point out a map, and I wasn't really looking, I just got to walk the other direction. Don't even know where I was born.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That's what I do when someone asks me, where are you from? I go... England, maybe. And then I just walk off.
I like the air of mystery. Maybe.
Maybe. It's like a tinge of sexiness. The ladies love that.
I don't think Zumi Ramen has a sexy bone in his body.
There's one sexy bone, but it never comes out.
Oh, God.
This is not a family podcast, by the way. To anyone listening, if they've been listening for the first time,
if anyone's gone on a romantic date
with their wife and said, "We'll take the Lincolncast with us,"
why would they do that?
It's just a neurotic, dysfunctional family.
In the car with your kid, listening to the Lincolncast for some reason, turn it off. Just turn it off.
No German families have done this.
Daddy, what's a Nazi? That's what I hope happened by now out there in the world.
Oh, Germany's raging right now. Yeah.
That's right. The entirety of Germany is listening to this podcast. Absolutely. They're coming for just Dourin and Cynic. They're just coming for you.
It's a problem though, because now we have to declare war on not just one country. We have to go in like all directions. It's gonna be a problem for us.
No, he lives in Austria. Germany or Cynic lives in Australia. You just need. Oh man.
Yeah, I forgot all those times you just attacked one country. God.
It's easy to break you. And we had to stop you. Oh, and then you just gonna forget the rest of the world because apparently only the Brits did it.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Fuck you guys.
Anyway.
So yeah, I have
Sookee,
not
what have you been
a casual racism podcast.
You haven't been up to much?
Not much. Nope.
Yeah, it's been a pretty uneventful week.
I guess so, yeah.
Well, so how'd you get on
the podcast? I mean, if anything, it's been a
rubbish week. You were just because you're pretty new to Giant Bomb, aren't you?
I'm very new, yes. I didn't really tend to frequent the site. But then I stumbled upon the podcast.
Wait, you found it through this? Oh.
Yeah, I think I was on Guild.
See, I think those guys should be paying us.
I think I was on
we're bringing traffic to their site.
And then I was just listening to the podcast, and then that's kind of how I found you guys. Yeah.
That's great. That was done with German efficiency.
That's German.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah.
That's all there is to him.
Wait, are you not wearing lederhosen?
I may be.
No, this will turn into the exact same conversations.
I kind of want it to happen. Do they have blue sky in Germany?
Is it all black and white like I saw in those films?
No.
Did you get your bread?
And the grass is green.
Wait, your grass is green?
Yeah.
Oh shit, it's not brown? And
dude, fuck, I'm moving to Germany.
Like America? Alright.
You should.
Ramen,
the grass is greener on the other side.
The grass is always greener on the other side, except when the other side is Germany. that's the full phrase. Nobody remembers that.
Against Germany, Zumi Ramen has one.
I thought Germany's real nice unless you're a Jew.
Yep. Oh my god! Really?
Stop!
I don't know. I'm not gonna cut that out. Alright, I apologize. But anyway, I like Germany. I like Germany. Zumi Ramen, what'd you be up to this week?
I played Rock Band Blitz.
Oh, how do you like Rock Band Blitz?
How was that?
I like Rock Band
Blitz. It looks so deep.
You're lying, aren't you? You didn't play Rock Band Blitz. Did you play Rock Band Blitz?
I played Rock Band Blitz. Yeah, I love Rock Band.
I don't know what it is. What is it?
I'm single-handedly keeping the rhythm genre alive.
You asked your question.
What is Rock Band Blitz?
It's you and Ryan Davis, and that's it.
Well, it's... I don't know how to describe it. Basically,
it's not you almost kind of need an entire podcast devoted to that game to describe it.
Right.
It's there's so much shit going on in there.
There's five tracks with different, like, drums singing. Some songs have a keyboard in there, weird songs. And then you're basically, like, a little ship. You're not a little ship. You're, like, on the track. I was thinking of Audio Surf for a minute. Rhythm games mixed up.
So it's like Audio Surf. It's not like Audio Surf, though,
is it? Like Audio Surf.
No, it's not like Audio Surf.
It's kind of a, I guess you can maybe say it's like a mix of like Audio Surf meets Rock Band, though.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. With how like with how
it's,
with
it's
how
a,
the
it's a bit more
the...
like amplitude and frequency, like the old school.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, so you understand that?
Just,
oh, yeah.
There's so many things going
really
on screen at once.
Obscure ones, but you don't get Rock Band.
Well, that's you know, if you've heard of it, Izumi Ramen doesn't like it.
Well, it's kind of like those games that were made by the guys that made Rock Band before they made Rock Band.
Yep. So it was when rhythm games
kind of
were
gone
indie
full circle
and good.
Wait, so is it a downloadable game? Or is it a full box?
Yes.
Yeah. It's downloadable. With a name like
and
Rock
actually,
Band,
all of your Rock Band stuff is able to be like imported into
yeah,
it.
That, it's oh, yeah, it's amazing. That is amazing. I looked at it and it was like a list of shame from how many points I've spent on like weird songs that I've never played.
Isn't like the awesomeness of the Rock Band franchise that you can do it with friends? Isn't this like single player only or some shit? Or
no, you can play with friends.
There's like a friends leaderboard kind of thing where you can like try to beat their scores, and you see that all kind of on screen in real time as you're playing.
To be fair,
but there's no actual catch co-op.
For me, when your group of friends bond over plastic instruments, it's actually the depressing moment of Rock Band.
So how'd you two meet? Oh, well, you know what?
She
played the plastic guitar, and it was just like magic.
Yeah. I got 98% of Room from the Hills with my double bass pedal. So.
We met like the Beatles, but we just played Rock Band.
Rock Band Beatles.
Yeah, I met the guitarist on top of the bus playing his plastic guitar. He was amazing.
And then we formed a rock band for Rock Band.
Saddest thing. It just
now I'm kind of depressed. Even more.
When I'm in the moment and I'm listening to the music and playing it, I'm fine. But I've muted it before.
Now,
Zimmy,
the real question
is good.
The real question is, did you buy the nickel pack?
Nickel pack.
Portmanteaus. No portmanteaus on this fucking show. I swear, I'll kill you.
I don't love you.
What?
I have bought a Nickel
I think
pack
that was
from,
Noobs.
Yes.
Oh, you did? Oh, wow.
Well, he's Canadian, so he's just channeling more the Canadian power, really. Chad Kroger.
Yeah, they're getting married, aren't they? The two worst people in the world.
Avril Lavigne.
Bringing Canada together.
Yep.
And Avril Lavigne, the royalty of Canada.
Yeah, is that like on all Canadian news? It's just like everywhere?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like if you actually trace back life in Canada, it comes from, they're like Adam and Eve. It just both comes from Chad Kroger and Avril Lavigne. That's the way it works.
And when the sterilization process happens, I don't know the exact
date. First. I can't wait to hear what musical talent their baby has.
Hasn't Avril been like
your
engaged multiple times?
Pardon?
Hasn't she been engaged like multiple times by now?
She was married to the some 82 guy, some 41, some 42.
Some
41, I don't fucking know.
Yeah.
There you go, Dourin just breaking out the fact. Yeah, some 41.
Yeah, some 41. That's you were thinking of Blink 182, but
yeah, I was mixing them together like some 42, and I'm like, that doesn't sound right.
I'll just look at my Google Docs for Avril Lavigne.
You know
marriages.
Blink 182. Okay, you know what? Let's just continue on because you are a terrible human being. If you, they're not necessarily good, but you know, if you don't know Blink 182, come on.
Oh, Blink 182. Wait, Zoomer, you don't know Blink 182?
Oh, Germany. Yeah, I know about Germany.
Oh, come on. Even I know Blink 182.
Like, don't hide your excuses with just...
No, I know
You can't hide
He's just lying now. He's just saying, I totally know.
No, guys. Guys, I've listened to Blink 182. Let me hang out with you.
This is like high school all over again.
Thing.
Hey.
All right. Like our musical talent.
Dourin. What have you been up to this week?
I have been looking at Gotham City's Imposters now that it's apparently free to play and considering installing and downloading and playing that game.
Wait, it's a great game. It's great.
Did it go free to play?
Are people still playing it?
It went free to play,
yeah.
It's
free to play.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Really? Like, recently,
the problem is, I think free to play in any video game, the free to play model is broken in any video game.
Any video really? Game. If you're playing that game and you're not paying for it, for every second you're playing,
yeah.
good luck having your game succeed.
If there's a cash store or there's like, I don't know, like gem store or something, it's just broken. It just breaks the game. Anything.
Well, it just makes them all pay to win, right?
Yeah, totally.
It just totally makes it pay to, like, you buy XP boosters. It's just horrible.
If the 1% can't be the most successful in that game, then you are not, it's not a game worth playing. Let's be honest.
Yeah, if you're in the 50% that can trade, then, oh, God, it's just a horrible, broken system.
Right.
But yeah, Gotham City Impostors is good.
So, Dourin, have you actually played it? Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I haven't.
I installed it.
Oh,
as far as I've gotten.
Because I bought it.
I'm the sucker that bought it.
I think it was like 15 euros, and I actually enjoyed it. The only problem is that there's like no one
euros.
Euros.
Oh, yeah.
Like, maybe it being free to play now means there will actually be people playing now.
Yeah.
The thing was, initially when I bought it, the server browser was run on a potato. So it was like the most horrendous.
Well, like, clocks can run on potatoes. Why not server browsers?
So it was run through GameSpy Arcade then.
Oh, snap.
Hey, my dad works for GameSpy.
No, he does not.
It was run through AOL gaming chat rooms. yeah, it was horrible, but they fixed it up, and it's actually a really fun game. Like, it's a
Could you actually run gaming servers off GeoCities? Is that a thing? Could you do that?
I don't think so.
I don't know. No, I tried it on Dreamweaver. It didn't work.
Anything else, Dourin?
No, pretty much that. And then... You know, read today and was kind of saddened about the closing of Paragon Studios.
All right.
Oh my god. So many people have died and so many shit has closed in the last week. What the fuck?
But really, I mean, City of Heroes, that's the biggest one.
Dude, 2012. That's happening. 2012.
What, yeah. you're saying the world is ending?
Yeah.
No, just famous people will die on 2012.
No, he's just saying, like, the year, it is happening now.
Yeah. That year is 2012.
Oh, yeah, he's just making a factual statement.
Do you not hear the maidens? One of their predictions was, like, I heard one of them said, like, City of Something would close down in 2012. No, I'm not a suspicious man. But that sounds pretty similar to what's happening.
Oh, God.
Ah, fuck. Numerama. What do you mean this week?
Oh, it's been pretty uneventful. Like, just something happened, so I haven't been... able to get any gaming time in. Like, I did buy a book.
I don't think there's any games out this week that you want to play, really.
I don't know.
It's just been a dead... It's a book called The Impossible State. It's about my home country, North Korea. And just about... it's great. It's by Victor Cha. He's like a famous NSC guy. And, you know, reading... It reminds me. It's all nostalgic. Like when I was running around, around the fields of Pyongyang, which there are none because it's all concrete.
Cool anymore that you're just not identifying with your actual home country, or you just really love North Korea and
What the hell's wrong with being proud of where I'm from? Are you criticizing me that I'm North Korean? Are you really going to do this right on the podcast?
you're not actually North Korean, noob.
Prove that. Prove it. Prove I'm North Korean.
I can't.
You can't.
I can't.
You can, exactly.
Can so you I'm sing North the Korean. Entire national anthem? Do it right now.
Huh?
Can you sing their entire national
that's
anthem?
It. Do that's it right it. Now. Oh, that's it. Done.
Oh, hail North Korea.
Yeah, see? You're not going to agree.
We stand
done.
On guard for the true patriot love in on our son's command.
Why would it be an English noob? Why would it be an English? I hate you so much. I hate you so much.
It's a really deep book. What's it called?
We're back, guys.
Yeah. It just really goes into the life of North, or just like the history, the modern history of North Korea. It's very decent read. Other than that, really, I haven't been doing much. There's only Borderlands 2 to look forward to. Like, that's when the summer drought ends.
Wait, did anyone get Dark Souls? Did anyone buy Dark Souls?
No.
Like, that game
PC
version.
No, I wanted to, but...
Like, they did release fixes for
it.
It's
not a very good PC port.
Yeah.
Well, I heard that a guy actually did, like, a kind of patch, like a fan patch of the game that kind of fixed the resolution problems.
Yeah.
So maybe it might be worth it because that, like, I don't know. I heard that the resolution was just kind of shit on the release version, and
it was almost like 720p or some shit, wasn't it? Some
No kidding.
Jokes aside, guys, come on. The big news, obviously, is that the PS Vita can now play PS1 games.
Wait, are you serious?
I immediately went and downloaded Final Fantasy VII on my Vita.
Holy crap!
I was playing it last night.
I downloaded Crash Team Racing, which is going to be controversial. The best kart racing game.
Oh no!
Well, you know what?
Oh no!
I didn't have that option because apparently, live in America, we only got like 7 games.
Yep. That
were.
To be honest, I've never played a kart racer outside of a kart racing mod in Counter Strike. So say all you want.
That was the first and the last.
The car
every
mod?
Game you've played, yep, every game genre you've played has just been a mod of Counter-Strike. I'm not playing an RTS outside of a mod for Counter-Strike.
Oh, I played Warcraft, but Warcraft Source for Counter-Strike.
Wait, you didn't play any CSGO this week, Noob?
Oh, crap. I've been really busy with stuff. I don't know. Just games.
Yeah.
Just nothing new with games recently. I don't know.
Exactly.
I spent about 6 hours downloading.
What were you downloading?
How is Counter-Strike go? Because I'm thinking about getting it.
It's really due to the fact that the majority of my friends who play Counter-Strike moved on to CSGO. It's why I'm moving. Like, they added a bunch of new guns, a bunch of new different game modes. The shooting is very different. It's no longer Sorcerer 1.6.
So let's simplify this. Sookee, how much Counter-Strike have you played in the past? Like, how into Counter-Strike are
you? Like, the first game actively played was Counter-Strike Source. That was like my first game at all, like ever on the computer. All
right.
So I was actually playing that. Yeah. Yep.
Your first game. Wait, are you like a bajillion 2 years old?
Yeah, sure. But like
you were a World War II veteran.
Previously to that, I was basically.
Weren't you in the SS? Were you lying about being in the SS? That's really low.
Wait, being in the SS or lying about it?
Yeah, I was going to say.
First game he played was Counter-Strike for real.
Oh, God. No, before that, I was mostly playing PlayStation 2 stuff and PlayStation.
Oh, okay, cool.
Tennis. Well, the reason I asked
you
is
played,
because, like...
You played Counter-Strike Go, the German operations, right? You played.
Oh, God. I love it.
The reason I asked is because, like, if you're not as, like, way deep into Counter-Strike as maybe someone like Noob is,
you'd
then Counter-Strike Go is fine.
Yeah.
It's actually a fine game.
Okay.
Yeah. The people that are complaining about it are the people who are
if you haven't put in 1,000 hours into Counter-Strike, I don't think it really matters.
I kind of did, but into Source.
Right. But so it is like the shooting is a big change, but once you get used to it, it's good old Counter-Strike is what matters.
Has the community moved over then? Have Valve got their wish of?
Well, the majority of people I play with have moved over. Yes.
Thurbleton's one issue is there's no sprays. I think that says more about
weird.
Him.
Yeah,
well, I think this says more about him because, than like, the Valve game.
If I'm not mistaken, like, there were sprays in.
He's really desperate for spray.
Go.
Look, if I could remove sprays from the game, I might as well, because some of those sprays you really do not want to see, and they don't disappear from your brain. Like,
that's true.
Like, I think you can relate with me because, like, you have some terrible war memories, I bet, Sookee. But it's just shit you don't want to ever think about.
So Guild Wars 2 came out this week.
Guild Wars 2 did come out this week. Guild Wars 2 did come out this week. You're right.
I'm pretty sure.
What came out?
I think Guild Wars 2 came out this week.
I'm pretty sure the beta just
I thought
started.
It was just...
Oh, right.
Yeah, it was just an extended beta weekend.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought they just forgot to turn off the stress test, and now they just don't know how to turn it off. The plug got stuck.
That's probably it.
I mean, I just assume that's why we don't have a trading post.
Yeah, that's exactly why we don't... Oh, shit, Guild Wars 2 came out.
Oh, wow.
What the fuck? Guild Wars 2 came out. What?
Yeah, I got a refund. I didn't like it.
Are you sure about that?
That's why I didn't play any games this week.
Oh.
Nailed it. Nailed it. Stuck the landing. Stuck the landing.
It. Wow. What the fuck? What the fuck?
Yeah, this if I don't take the reins on this, it's just gonna be us sitting around going, "Oh God, guys.
Guild Wars 2 came out! Oh, golly God. Gosh!
What the fuck? All right,
it's been at least 3 months since I was hyped for this game.
Yeah,
I only learned about it 3 months ago, to be honest.
Dourin, take us to the news this week. What's up?
News this week: Guild Wars 2 came out.
What okay, the fuck?
Yeah, all right. Yep.
What the fuck? Golly gosh, Mary Sue! Guild Wars 2 just came out!
What was that? What impression was that?
Fuck if I know. I was just excited. Yeah, I don't Guild Wars 2 came out. Guild Wars 2 came out.
Was that like, was that your American?
No, just like, 1950s.
No, that was his German.
Yeah. It was, oh, okay.
You know, like like in the documentaries about World War II, I'm sure
Snooki is
familiar with this.
Guild Wars 2 out in Germany.
Like, wait, can you do a German accent, noob? Try it.
Well, all of my German knowledge is from video games like Company of Heroes, so not really.
So it's totally super duper good.
Scheisen! Oh, Panzerkampfkommander! Jawohl!
Oh, God, oh yeah, gonna...
Wait.
Guild Wars.
Oh, God.
Yeah, twist my nipples. Oh, yeah.
So one of you...
Tie me up
and
tell me about the
German
Asura, you dirty Norn.
Pardon?
What was
one
that?
Of you has all the, like, all the German knowledge from a video game, and the other one... Mm-hmm. Has got it from
porn.
Questionable video sources.
For both. Both. In fact, I'm sure some of them are the same thing.
Dude, I played Leisure Suit Larry in German.
Yeah. What? You play that in German? I need to buy Leisure Suit Larry. Yeah. I need to buy Leisure Suit Larry.
That makes the game so much better. So Guild Wars 2 released.
What the fuck?
Yeah, that.
What the fuck? Oh, good. Twist my nipples. Did Guild Wars 2 really release?
So... In Guild Wars 2's release, things didn't go completely perfectly, though I think we can pretty much all agree it was still a fairly good, solid release.
Playability-wise.
But then again, I felt like the entire time Guild Wars out, or Arena Net was out to sabotage my Guild Wars 2 experience. I did feel that. Did you not feel that?
I think you were maybe out to sabotage your own Guild Wars 2 experience.
No, like, guilds weren't up, like, all of these problems, and then they told me, if you keep on slandering us on your podcast, we're going to ban your account.
Well, to be fair, right. With the guild stuff, like, how much of that did you personally end up actually having to deal with?
Me? A lot. What are you talking about?
I swear. New kind of did stuff on the first day, and then just was like, whatever.
What
and
are
just
you
fucking
saying?
Ran off in his own direction.
What? I am so offended you just said that. You don't know how many hours I've spent. You were. Fuck you. Fuck you. I'm out.
You spent an hour, and then you got your chef's outfit and fucked off to do some.
I didn't get a chef's outfit. I bought 2 bank tabs instead.
You loser.
Did you actually. I know. Did you. Buy gems, or did you?
No, I used in-game gold.
Yeah, but in-game and got bank tabs.
Yep,
that's pretty impressive.
Anyway,
playability was overall pretty solid. Yeah. There was some downtime. I believe it was like Saturday night. It was down for 6 hours or something. I heard.
Yeah.
But other than that, it's only really ever gone down.
I remember
waking
up to it going down, and I'm like, so it was a beta weekend. Because,
yeah.
<fuck you>.
There's been some lag issues that have kind of persisting even past the weekend. But they've gotten less and less. There were some early login issues that have since been fixed, it seems like. Probably the
I don't know, man.
The biggest things that persist are things like the trading post, the mail, party joining.
Open up your guild tab, see how your frames per second goes, because it drops to 5.
But at least people can join guilds properly now. Yeah. Like that part has been fixed.
Yeah, but for someone
and
who
probably
has to
most importantly,
people,
like ArenaNet's been very, very good with staying vocal and kind of staying out there with the community and keeping us constantly updated. Like there have been hundreds of tweets per day. Like I've been watching it every day, and it's just it's constant. Like they're constantly
millions of tweets.
Millions upon millions.
Oh no,
of
no.
Tweets.
Okay, no, stop. You stop it. You stop that right now. Okay.
Extreme.
God damn it.
It's new Roma. Can you run me through? Last week we got on here. It was a live show.
Love you guys.
And then I was just pressing login, and suddenly they gave me a EULA, and I'm like, "Holy shit, guys!" And then
last week we pretty much said what we were gonna do in the first couple of days for Guild Wars 2. And so problems included. What was your first hours, days with Guild Wars 2, Noob Roma?
Well, the first hour was inviting people.
It was pretty much, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh man.
And then my game crashed, and I'm like, okay, maybe I'll just fucking go to sleep because it was 5 in the morning, and then I slept for about 3
Wait,
hours.
So which character names did you get of the ones?
I'm so happy I got these. So the 5 character names I got, because like the second I did it, I immediately did skip to end character name, log out, skip to end character name, log out. I did that 5 times.
Yeah.
Character's name I got were the protagonist.
right?
The main character.
I can't believe you got both. It's so fucking. It's and I asked him for one, and he's like, nope.
Yeah, go. How about you go suck my dick? Is what I said. I recall very clearly. And then
is
I took
that one of your characters.
I took Human Mesmer, and then I got Brohan Solo, and no, then the fifth one, I fucking don't remember what the fifth one was anymore.
That's something pretty good. That's a pretty good role.
Yeah. Oh, I think it might have been like the Vault Dweller or something. I don't remember.
What?
Like from Fallout 1? Okay. Fuck you. Just fuck you.
So you got your names.
Dude, I've never heard of Fallout.
And then I just ran around in the human story. By the way, I'm planning on still making all human. Actually, no. I might go back on my all human policy just because the personal stories are fucking amazing.
They are really good, right?
They are so good.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
But we'll go to there. That is a story for another hour of today.
So, Noob, are you saying that Cerberus will not exist then?
Cerberus
will
exist.
Because you can't stay true to Cerberus's...
I'll have these characters created for genetic experiments. How about that?
Oh, okay.
Yep. That fits with
the lore. Oh, dude, see if we can get genetic experiment as a name.
Oh, that's probably... good luck with that. That's probably Guild Wars 1 stuff.
Now you've just put it live. It's gone.
Yeah,
it's gone.
Oh, shit, we are live.
I've just got it.
So I ran around for a bit, went to bed, woke up to it being down, and then I'm like, okay, fuck this game. So I quit.
So you really just played 1 hour, huh?
I mean, like, if they're going to treat me like I paid for this game. If they're going to treat me like that, fuck you.
Like a second-class North Korean citizen.
Like, I get better treatment.
Well, he doesn't know the anthem, so...
I just sang the anthem. You can't prove it. Actually, you probably can, but you can't prove it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure Dourin has the power right now to put it up on stream, but we're not going to do that. But yeah, so what did you do on your second day? Well, how about we just go around and ask everyone what their first day was? Dourin, what was your first day like in Gozu?
My first day was me making my elementalist. I continued the stream going and just kind of playing through that character.
What'd you name
the
characters?
I think I made a couple others, but I pretty much just stuck with that one.
What'd you name them?
What's that?
What'd you name them?
Is Tesla Bordeaux.
The fuck is that? I don't understand.
I know, right?
It's too funny at all.
Are you gonna go into the Grove in Cyber with that? You freak?
Hey, I'll have you know I have gotten at least one compliment on my name, thank you.
Well,
but
from me.
Hey, why don't you take off your blouse or something like that? You're pretty sexy.
Take off your blouse.
The most proper of perverts. Yeah.
So yeah, that was pretty much my first day. It was just enjoying that one character.
Wait, so it's a human? It's a human on this, right?
What are your other character names? What are your other character names? Oh, I have a human guardian, by the way. Yeah.
My other characters, they're not quite as maybe good as the ones that Noob got, but I got I made a Asura Mesmer and named it Trixie Asura.
Just delete it. Just delete it. No point.
I made an Asura guardian.
I like that name. Trixie Asura
of the guard.
Ian of the Guard?
Ian of the Guard.
What? Yes. Is that a reference?
It's a guardian.
To being in guardian.
I am laughing so hard my intestines are falling out of my stomach. Wait, what?
Ian of the Guard.
So it's... All right, so that was pretty much it. You just played the personal story for the first day?
I pretty much just played the personal story and just normal leveling with that character. I still to this day have not touched structured or World versus World.
So everyone here, did anyone have any serious fucking connection issues the first day or login issues?
Yeah, I actually haven't had that other than the drop day. I didn't get disconnected at all. I'll credit them that just so I could suffer through all of the bugs without being disconnected. I'm pretty sure that was their reason.
I didn't get disconnected.
I think I got one disconnect, and then I immediately got back.
I got one disconnect, the odd one, and a bit of lag. But apart from that, no, it's fine.
Snooki? I get the occasional disconnect, I guess. I guess I don't know if that's. I think the EU servers they were down twice.
Right.
And I guess so.
You're right for being a European.
Even though I'm playing on the US server. I guess I was affected by
with our
the
economy
EU
and stuff.
Going
we're
down
on
the servers.
Must be in Greece or Portugal or something.
Yeah, the servers were in Greece.
They had to, like, scuttle them. I'm sorry for any... Well, actually, I'm not sorry for any Greek listeners.
Wait, why aren't you sorry? You just hate the Greeks
because they live in Greece.
I feel sorry for Sookee, who has to pay for them.
I'm sorry that they're Greek.
So what did you do on your first day, Sookee?
Well, I don't know.
I love calling you Sookee. His name, his in-game name.
He's a big... It's because he's a big fan of Jersey Shore, right?
Yeah, it's because he's a big fan of Jersey Shore.
Yes, I watch it frequently every day in Germany. Because that's what we—that's all we do in Germany, really.
Yeah, you GTL all the time. GTL.
I feel extremely attracted to her. So.
Is it in German? Is it like do you have dubbed German version? Oh yeah, give me that fake tan.
Honestly, I
feel
think
so it's... sorry for him. He's just taking all the shit from. Oh,
oh, it's okay. It's totally fine. I don't think we have like I don't even think we we receive it here.
But you wouldn't watch
you.
Either.
You are like a classy person who wouldn't watch that show.
So basically, my name, my in-game name is Sookee and not Snooky.
How do you spell it?
You spell it S-O-O-K-E-E. Yeah. And
what's that reference to? Like, how is that a thing?
It's the Japanese word for love.
Is it
exactly?
Fuck off.
I think it's spelled S-U-K-I though.
Yeah.
Well, that's just entirely different then. That's literally entirely different.
That's a different word.
Well, this is
just
the German
two
spelling.
Letters.
See,
the German
is,
spelling.
The thing is, I had 15 names prepared, just about 15.
Run me through them.
What?
Run me through them. I want to know.
That would take
all 15.
Yeah. Oh, it might have been more actually. And I tried to get them,
what?
Obviously. And I got up at 6 a.m. because you know they said that the servers would go up like.
And they did. They did
at
right
9
on time.
Or 3 hours, like up to 3 hours earlier. Yeah. And obviously, I got up like 3 hours earlier at 6 a.m. And I logged in, and all my names were gone. So I had to. I chose. Sookee with the double E instead of the IE, I guess. That's how this went down.
Oh, wait, so you were actually going for that? I it was just an actual guess? Wow. Wow.
What you... going for what? I was not going for Sookee.
Wait, oh, no, like...
I was going for Sookee with IE at the end, and now I have
Sookee.
Double E at the end.
Okay.
Are you disappointed at everything?
I was
hate
very
the world
disappointed.
Now.
I do. Well, I did at the time, but now I'm better. And
what
other
characters' names did you?
I honestly,
pick up?
I honestly
this is how
don't
World
know.
War III is going to happen, guys.
I don't know.
You don't remember them?
Somebody's not going to get their name.
I have one more that I remember. It's chocolate chip.
But you got that. Right?
That's racist.
Oh, yeah. Chocolate chip. What?
Yeah. So that's
is chocolate chip racist?
No.
Yeah,
if you're a racist, then you immediately pick that up as a racial slur.
What does it mean? What's it referring to?
To a freaking chocolate chip.
Same white people don't taste as good as chocolate.
No, I like chocolate.
What?
I like chocolate chips.
That might be like, oh, you have brown spots all over your body. You're a chocolate chip cookie. But I'm sure that's making
racist.
Fun of someone with a disability or like a physical skin condition than someone with
disability.
Oh, but I'm of the race of the polka dot people. Don't call me chocolate chip. I'll get offended.
Well, clearly,
I don't even know what's going on anymore.
It's not racist. What the fuck is happening? Oh my god.
It's not racist.
It's surrealism.
I like chocolate chip cookies, and I thought chocolate chip would be a fun name. So
I have to say, Sookee has been on the show because he's like the biggest champ. He's like every time we just take it to fucking task and everything he does, and he's just like, you know, just be polite, just nice about it, and just keeps trucking on.
Like, I thought you would be like the ideal Canadian, not me.
Would I?
We'll reach his breaking point. Well, don't you worry. We'll get there eventually.
And suddenly, so
yeah, then we'll record it.
Is that what
you're
saying?
And then it's the Blitz all over again.
I'm scratching. Like...
I'm actually planning it right now.
Yeah. Oh, totally, totally.
Are you scratching yourself
happening.
Thinking about killing Jews?
You should look outside, dude. maybe you don't want to.
He's just distracting us.
I'll just see you in a plane, just like.
I just need to enter one code. is one code, and it's all gone. No, so it's all
gone.
My first day was I spent most of my first day just in game, I guess. Like nothing was working. I guess the party system wasn't working, and the trading post wasn't working.
Dude,
so I mostly
wait. So that was the same for everyone, right? Like you just couldn't get parties.
No, it was just for you, Cynic. They didn't like you. They don't like you.
As far as I know, it was for everyone.
Just for the Australians and Germans.
Yeah.
So
it's because they're like neighbors. They're just the same geographic.
Yeah, the real second class citizens in the world.
Wait, so the guild, because we got on, we made the guild, and then everything was going fucking smoothly, and then
the invites were working for the first bit.
Yeah. Everything was working fine. And then suddenly just everything just stopped working. Like everything. Like you couldn't party up, we couldn't enter the same instance, we couldn't
Oh, that instance thing was fucking killer.
Oh man, yeah.
I mean that is
getting logged off. I got logged off once, but I know Shav the World, one of the past guests, and the Brit who's better than Zumi, who's usually on the show, it had some serious connection issues, and it just kept getting knocked out, and I think that only stopped recently. Like, everything fucking, and the trading post didn't work. Let's not forget that. The trading post did not work for... It still doesn't work, does it? Anyways, yeah, Snooki.
It works for the...
For the 25% minority.
Isn't it 50 now?
Or majority.
No.
Occupy Lion's Arch. Anyone doing Occupy Lion's Arch? I'm gonna tent. I'm gonna camp up.
What, we are the 50%? It doesn't work when there's an equal. are the 50%. It doesn't work.
We're the half of the population that won our rights.
Yeah, nice. To the trading post.
So, anyways, I basically stuck to just running my personal story. I think did we hit level 30 on the first day? I don't think, but we came pretty close, I guess.
What? How?
Didn't we?
Yep.
Did we not?
I did.
I think we did. Yeah. Well, you didn't, but like no everybody else did.
like everyone who matters.
Exactly. Wait.
No, I hit like 25 on the first.
Yeah,
day.
That sounds about right. Yeah.
That's
Wait,
what
how
I
many hours did you play?
The entire day.
Like 20? Yeah.
What the fuck? What's wrong with you people? Oh my god.
Like, I had 39 hours in the first, when it said, like, 39 hours in one day is what it said for me when I checked, like, 2 days in. That's what it said.
That's true.
Oh, the next day. Right. Yeah. That's fucking batshit crazy. You guys are...
Well, I don't know
anyway,
about that.
Anyway. Really? That really?
It's a fun game.
20 hours straight? That just sounds like madness.
It's a fun game. And
yeah, it's a fun game.
I guess we have been waiting for it.
Yeah, for 5 years.
So, yeah, there you go.
Wait, did you play Duelist One, Snooki?
I did not when it was out, like when it first launched. I played it, I don't know, like 6 months ago. I got it for the Hall of Monument stuff. I installed it. I played it for, like, say, 13 seconds, and I quit.
Oh man!
As would be expected, because if you didn't play that game at launch,
at that point,
you shouldn't play that game.
6 months ago, I was playing that game like an hour a day, every day.
Yeah, you are, but you're crazy.
I'm not crazy. I mean, I can see how it's probably really good, but it just feels so clunky. Or I don't know. There's no jump. I mean, seriously, there's no jump.
There's no panzers.
There's no jump.
There's no panzers.
And there's no giant Norn boobies. So.
There's no jumpers.
Well, you're not playing a Norn.
Oh yeah, there are giant Norn boobies. You just can't play them.
Oh, they are. Yeah.
Well, if they're not
you can't
playable,
make them jump.
Then yeah, I'm out.
Well, you're
Wait,
not even
you're playing
as a
Norn.
Well,
yeah.
Not right now. That's not
you scum.
Might be my master plan though. You never know. You never know. Oh, we're sneaky.
Whenever you Germans say master plan, I just get scared.
We're sneaky. That's the best.
Self-fulfilling prophecy.
I'm glad
right
you said
now.
That name, not me.
Yeah, that's the thing now.
I'm going to create that character. I'm just going to delete Vault Dweller. Create Sneaky Sookee. Oh.
So yeah.
Anyway.
I think I got
yeah, so, so wait, you play... So you're a human elementalist, right? As well?
Yes.
So wait, we've got two human elementalists, a human guardian, I'm a human warrior. Zoom around what you've been playing.
Well, still... I woke up. and then I realized...
Wait, what are we talking about now?
My first day in Guild Wars, because I want the spotlight.
Okay, go.
Well, I woke up and realized, you know, probably wouldn't be online, but I turned my Xbox on, and there was Rock Band Blitz. So I...
Wait, so you actually played Rock Band Blitz?
No, because you
didn't. I downloaded Rock Band Blitz. Oh. Yeah, I played that for a bit. It's really good DLC, good DLC. And then I went on Guild Wars 2. I started a Silvari Thief. Realized I'm not very good at Guild Wars 2.
And quit forever.
Then deleted my Silvari Thief, and then started a Charr Necromancer.
Wait, you really? That's your fault that you are low level.
Your thief?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't like. I've got an OCD about characters and stuff. If I'm not gonna play,
oh,
it,
I hear
then,
you. Yeah.
But didn't you fall in love with a thief earlier? What happened?
What
that was
happened?
Me?
Yeah, I did, but I realized that was for 5 levels, and then outside of those 5 levels, I was like, I'm not very good at video.
Wait, how high did you take your thief?
I think it was about 55 when I deleted it.
No, like actually,
like 13.
That's still pretty high.
That's pretty high. That's like 7 hours of play, right?
Yeah.
And then you just think, well, fuck this. And what was wrong with the thief? It was just too, it's
too
it's
squishy.
Pretty twitch, right?
Yeah, I was like, I wasn't used to it. Like, that seems to be, like, that's the most one of the most Guild Wars class combat wise, like jumping about and diving about and dodging. Like, I'm not into that. I'm not that flexible. So I was like,
what do you mean you're not that flexible?
Like, my fingers aren't set up for that yet.
I was going to say, Jamie, you do realize
you can't bend
you're not
his fingers
do...
back 90 degrees.
No, I can't. My mingers. My
fingers. In Britain, they don't
racist?
Have fingers.
Is that a racist term?
We just have fingers.
Yeah.
My APM is about 3, if in, like, StarCraft terms. So... Yeah,
so you're playing a mini monster necromancer? Is that what you're saying?
I'm playing Minga Master Necromancer. It's fun. I like the necromancer quite a lot.
Hey, what are you doing? So, what level are you now? How long have you progressed? Well, how much do you play in the first day? Because like, we're going to get to there. But how much did you play in the first day?
Not long, really, because I got up quite early, played it for a bit, and then had work and was like,
oh, yeah, that's right.
Got home and was like, I got up early, so I'm going to go to bed. So I got up the next day and was like, oh, I have work today.
This topic
we'll get to a day when I did
boring topic. I fucking hate you. I hate you all. I hate you all. Dourin, what's the next news topic?
Wait, what are you playing? How was
Cynic.
Tell
so
us
I,
about yourself.
I've got, okay, to go on through my characters. What's your character? What's your character name?
What's my character name?
Yeah. Is it a Puntastic?
No, he's called Crinus. I don't do silly names.
It's just Socrates.
He just
suggested
them for everyone else. I think you got like 3 people using names you've suggested. I fucking hate you so much. And they're all fucking terrible puns and portmanteaus.
What ones?
I don't remember. I just know there's
I'm sure someone did Asurable because of you.
Oh, absolutely.
Asurable? Yeah, most. Vines of Warrior?
That happened. I fucking hate you.
Mustafi, anyway. I like him too. I'm 50 Cent though.
Sounds like a place from Star Wars, Mos Def.
Is it? I don't think so.
Yeah, like,
Mos definitely.
Yeah, it's like
just
over off of Mos.
Oh snap!
Can we?
So
him from this
so
podcast?
I'm playing a human warrior called Human Warrior. I have an Asura Guardian called Asura Guardian. I fucking love both of those. I have a one I'm holding. With the name is Evil Doer. And then I have an empty slot. Two empty slots. That's my current.
Good. Two empty.
And you call my name boring.
Yeah, evil. Wait, no, evil doer is better than fucking.
No, evil doer is okay. Evil doer is okay. But human warrior and a certain guardian.
So good. They're so good. I love them so much.
You say that now, but when he's selling that account for $8 billion, which is like $5 in this today's money,
yep.
In the future.
today's money in the future.
He's kind of inflation.
Inflation, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm telling
you. So, like, $5.
$8.
$5.
Yeah. I love those. I played... So, the first day was fucking getting online, inviting people to the guild. I got a job, which is awesome. And then fucking played...
What, in Guild Wars?
No, I got a real job. Like, finally.
To play
finally
Guild
got a real job.
There's a real job?
I'm not sure anymore. I'm not sure anymore.
Are you playing Rock Band Blitz for money?
So, wait. You got a job, but then Guild Wars 2 launched. So are you really that excited about the job?
Dude, I don't want to start on Monday. I do not want to start on Monday. You have no idea. Anyway, bring us to the next news topic.
Next news topic was that ArenaNet kind of wasted no time banning people. Nope. There have already been some... They were called bans, 72-hour suspensions that had
some
gone
of them were
perma-banned,
though.
Yeah.
Well, first off, the first they ones were 72-hour bans for name issues and chat activity that was less than stellar. And there was a big uproar about it because people were given just kind of given immediately a ban. There was no warning, no, like, hey, just change your name. Maybe followed up by a 24-hour or something. It was just straight up 72-hour ban, name change required. And that kind of blew up a lot in the community and kind of got blown way out of proportion. So ArenaNet kind of took to Reddit and said, hey, look, if you think that you were wrongly banned, come on here, tell us what your character name is, and we will tell you why you were banned. And they did not hold back whatsoever. There was some very colorful language that ArenaNet... relayed back to people that they had said maybe in chat for their reason for their banning or for their suspension. And then following that, some more 72-hour bans as well as permanent bans were given to people for an exploit that they had discovered with karma weapons that they were able to purchase for way, way lower than the intended cost. And they were basically buying hundreds, and from what I was hearing, sometimes thousands of these weapons and throwing them in Mystic Forge and basically just making themselves crazy gear and making crazy gear to sell and make a bunch of money off of. The people that only did maybe a couple of those were only given the 72-hour ban, whereas people that seemed like they were doing 100-plus were all given permanent bans. And ArenaNet basically kind of came out and said like they wanted to put, basically use them as an example, like that they are not going to fuck around when it comes to exploits. Like, if you find an exploit, you tell ArenaNet about it. You don't actually abuse the exploit, and then just wait for it to be fixed. And after kind of that initial wave of bans went out, they came back out and said, "Look, you know, we wanted to make sure that we got that message out there. It seems like that message was clear. And for this time only, we will allow those people that were permanently banned to petition to drop their ban to a 72-hour ban." With the promise of once they get their account back, they have to go on, delete any crafting materials, any of the weapons, and any money that they made from those from their account, and the ArenaNet will actually go back and check it, and if those are not deleted, their account will be re-terminated with no chance of getting it back.
Wait, so who's played other MMOs? I know, Sookee, you've played a bunch of World of Warcraft, and Dourin, you also played a bunch of World of Warcraft. And Zoom, when you play a bunch of World of Warcraft, so pretty much everyone else, except for Noob, who doesn't count, played World of Warcraft.
RuneScape is an MMO. What the hell? What's with all of this? Oh. Bah humbug. Wait, no, nice. That's not until Christmas.
So how do you guys feel about this approach to censorship, or even go to censorship, but keeping things moderated? I don't know, Sookee.
Personally, I feel that they have taken the right steps. Really?
It sounds like, just for me, it sounds like a little. So how they approach similar stuff in WoW? Did they just instant ban people? Because
that's kind of the problem is that they didn't, and so that community has kind of gone to shit.
Right.
So like the first step that the ArenaNet took that a lot of MMOs don't is the kind of cracking down on the naming stuff. And then also cracking down on chat. Like, that was something... You can say some pretty heinous things in WoW before you finally get banned. And even when you do get one, it's like a 24-hour suspension, and then you're back again.
Well, do you have any examples of names they banned for?
Names? I don't have any examples of names, necessarily. Other than the one guy on Giant Bomb who posted a thread because he had gotten a 72-hour suspension. And his name was Holy Fuck, spelled to look Asian.
Wait, what?
So it's like HO LEE PHUK.
How is that Asian?
How long was?
That looks
Dourin
like
is just a racist, Asian. So he thinks anything that looks weird is Asian.
It's not still right. It's Asian.
Wait. So he got 72 hours.
Yeah,
he got 72-hour ban and a required name change.
I don't think he should be banned for that. That's genius.
Yeah, I think he should be warned there's for it, but I don't think he should get a fucking 72-hour ban.
To me, there's a difference between, like, funny names like Human Warrior.
Okay. And I don't think that's a very funny name.
That are just don't belong in an MMO, like Holy Fuck.
I agree.
Okay, but don't ban them on Holy Fuck. It's Holy Fuck. 72 hours.
No, I think it's the perfectly appropriate step to take.
Yeah, tell them, do this again, we'll ban you, but for now you get a name.
The other thing too about this game is, like, if somebody gets a 72-hour ban, it's... You're getting a 72-hour ban from a game that, like, they can do this in this one because there is no subscription fee, so it's not like they're taking your money.
Oh yeah,
by doing so.
It's very true. So all you're doing is you get banned from your name on launch day. You paid in advance for this game so you can have it 3 days early.
And you should have thought about that before you decided to create a character named Holy Fuck.
Exactly.
I don't think your decision to ride that line. 72-hour ban. Okay, I understand that they shouldn't have that name and they should get banned if they are repeat offenders. But if on the first day they make Holy Fuck, sure, tell them. You're going to change your name, else otherwise we're going to ban you off this game.
Well, no, the reason why it's okay is because whenever you first booted the game up, and then whenever this Holy Fuck guy booted the game up for the first time before making his character, he agreed to the terms of service. And in their terms of service,
absolutely,
it outlines exactly what their name is.
No, I'm not saying they can't do that. I'm just saying I feel like it's a bit draconian to do that immediately without any sort of warning to them. Because did you fucking read the EULA? Because I sure as hell did not read the EULA.
I didn't, but I've played enough games to know, like, you don't do stuff like that in a game. Like, there are certain things you don't...
Well, I think the problem is that in other games, I think you would get away with it, personally. Yeah. I think if I was
if
in
I named my
Warcraft,
Steam name, Holy Fuck, I don't think I'd get banned.
I actually know a WoW player whose name is Holy Fuck, just spelled like that, and he's still running.
Yeah,
with the character.
But see, that's the thing, though, is that by them doing this, like, everyone, especially with the coverage that it ended up getting, like, kind of around the community and stuff, like, now people kind of know, like, you, like, watch what you name your character. Don't be fucking stupid.
Right.
And don't think just because you think it's funny that everyone else will think it's funny.
Okay, it's fair to ban them outright. Sure, they agreed to it, whatever, but I just don't think it was the right thing to do, per se.
For the community's sake, it's absolutely the right thing to do.
How much do you think this comes from them just not having the time to do it the slow way?
They could just send an automated message.
I don't think it's faster or slower.
Yeah,
I mean,
100% about setting an example. And, like,
absolutely.
In 6 months, like, the names won't be as tightly moderated as they are today.
And that's why I think it's a good thing. I think they need to set an example. And, you know, if they don't do it right off the bat, then it's not going to work.
Well, I personally don't... Because the main argument for the name thing is to not break people's immersion and to allow the game to be somewhat safe for kids. Like, you don't want a kid to be saying, for example, jumping on the equivalent of Mumble and their parents be walking by while he's quoting the other person's name and saying, hey, holy fuck, get over here. Holy fuck, get over here. And, you know, if he's like 12 years old, it might not be very appropriate. But,
should be playing the game.
And also immersion breaking, like for the role players, they don't want to see my name's going to anger some people. Not many.
Well, yeah, exactly. The immersion breaking though, that's not an issue. I don't think that's what they're worried about, because otherwise names like yours would probably get flagged because it is out of, you know, context of the universe.
And if they did that, holy shit!
Yeah, if they went that far, that would be going way too far.
It's holy shit. Another name that got banned.
Yeah, probably.
If you got a 72-hour ban for Human Warrior,
it's spelled Asian
or fecal matter. Asian.
That would be ridiculous, but no, it's not so much an immersion breaking as it is just kind of setting an example for the community of, like, look, this is what we'll put up with, this is what we won't put up with. Like they said on the Reddit thing when they were talking about some of the chat stuff that people got banned for, so people were asking,
is,
like, does this mean
is...
I can't cuss in chat? And if that's the case, what's the filter for? And they responded saying, like, no, you know, we understand, you know, things slip occasionally. And, you know, you might, you know, you died or something and you said shit or whatever the case might be. Like, we're all adults here. We all play video games. We understand how that works. But there's a difference between, you know, kind of throwing a cuss word out here and there and some, you know, hateful language or, in the case of these names, just outright profane names that they're naming these characters.
That Reddit
trying to
was
mask it behind.
Hilarious. Yeah. Absolutely. did you read it? Or can you outline for what it was? They made a Reddit thread, right?
Yeah, they made a Reddit thread where basically, I kind of mentioned it in passing earlier, but basically where, like, because there was such an uproar of these, because of these bans, and, like, it was kind of getting way overblown of, like, why people were being banned and people claiming they were being banned for something that they clearly weren't. So they came out on Reddit and said, look, you know, if We stand behind our bans. If you feel like you were unjustly banned, then put your character name in here, and in this public forum, we will tell you why you were banned.
I love it. And best idea. Best did. Idea.
Like, I think the second one that was on there was, like, the person put their character name in or whatever, and ArenaNet responded back with, your name is okay, chat is not okay, and then the quote from the chat was something along the lines of, like, this isn't Africa, you don't sell little black kids or something.
Yeah, you can't adopt little black kids.
Yeah, like, somebody actually put that into chat and then wondered why they got banned.
That's just...
I might be banned very soon.
I've been walking around saying, is this Africa?
It's fine. Okay. The problem is, what they did is they never really had guidelines out before the game was out. Like, you should not do this, you should not do that. And there's no, like, written law of the internet of common sense because this internet.
There is the fucking internet,
by the way.
There are moral guidelines, and you should know that there are certain things you don't say in a public forum. You don't go to Walmart.
Well, no, I'm not talking about, like, throwing out racial slurs. I'm talking about names. Just sticking names. That one was, sure, ban him for that, but...
Well, yeah, so, because banning for chat, I'm fine with, and I definitely, the banning for the other stuff, which we'll get to, the economic stuff, but the name stuff, I think, to what extent could they have done a little bit more of communication? Because that last page there is pretty much just your personal story laid out, then a name slot. It doesn't say on that last page as well... Like, even below the name, like, small print or whatever, just anything there, that these names will be moderated. It doesn't even really tell you in any way.
They never told these players what not to do beforehand. Like, sure.
Well, they did. Don't cuss into chat. Terms of service.
Yeah, but the people have already lost lawsuits by claiming the terms of service agreements because it's pretty much recognized that most people don't read, even law, that most people don't read to EULAs. And it's not too much to ask. Like, I know they want to make the personal story thing really important and that to be the emphasis of that last character creation.
I agree. It's bad to have people named Holy Fuck running around, but I don't think on day one, without any sort of warning beforehand, just ban them
even
for
if they
72
just put
hours.
Two sentences below the character name thing, entering thing, of, like, be aware that offensive names will be harshly moderated. Like, just literally that statement just there. Would be awesome, and that would go a long way. It would save them effort in the long run. I just don't know why.
I guess maybe that's something they may add later on, but I guess maybe they just kind of assumed that people would be intelligent enough to know that this is a fucking MMO.
That's the funny thing, right? Because they had the betas, and I'm pretty sure they didn't have anywhere near this much problems with like terrible names in the betas. I think they just weren't expecting it, like, to that extent.
Yeah,
I think the thing is, like, nobody's been sort of used to this sort of heavy-handed moderation, I think, in MMO-wise and things like that. Like, some of the, like, talking about the chat, like, you could say that in WoW, I reckon, and you could get away with it, or you could say it in wherever you can get away with it. Like, some of it was, like racist and stuff.
There's
and,
no
like,
standard MMO guideline on how to behave on the internet. That's the problem.
Like, people were getting banned for stuff they were saying in parties, like, I think, and, like, saying, oh, you're shit at this game, you're going to have to, like, go fuck a goat or something. Like, I'm not saying that's totally acceptable, but I'm saying I've seen...
Was that a dig at our German?
Like, wow.
Was that a dig at our German? Because of the goat thing.
No, that was a dig at the Welsh.
Oh. Yeah, that was...
okay.
I may or may not be Welsh, but I may be English. but I'm just... There's, like... It just seems really heavy-handed for the start of an MMO. Like, I just think they need to be careful on saying, like, because everyone on Reddit's like saying, "Oh, thanks, ArenaNet, for, you know, taking it seriously, doing this." But it's like, people just think you're dicks. Like, just think.
Well, no,
ArenaNet
see, that's the thing, though, is the only people that seem to really think that ArenaNet are being dicks about it are people who are using these names.
Yeah,
Well, I'm not, and not I think really. They're being a bit dickish.
I think they're being a bit dickish. Yeah, as well.
Because I think they shouldn't ban. They should just why ban them 72 hours when you can literally say.
I don't know, Zumi. As somebody,
I think it's okay if you put that warning that Cynic talked about.
Really,
that's completely fine. But if you have no warning.
As somebody who spent years in the WoW community, are you really thinking that it's too heavy-handed to kind of try to stamp this out now as opposed to letting it turn into that type of community?
I think that saying, change your name, please, also if it happens again, 72 hours ban is on your way, is a much better way of doing it. Like, you know, it's just like saying, I don't know, I can't really compare it to anything because I can't Nothing think of a crime has, that's yeah. not worthy of jail. But, like, basically just, I just think there needs to be something before you're handing out something to our bands, right. because that seems like two steps up in terms of being like, punishing someone.
Again, this is on Head Start. These people have been waiting for this game. They bought early on, they wanted to play. And if you're not, they had no warning whatsoever, and they're banned for 72 hours.
Well, and I will say too, like ArenaNet's not backing down on this either. They were kind of called out from a couple people as saying like, you know, wasn't this kind of a little too much? Like, you know, there was no warning. It was just immediately hit the 72 hour ban. There was no like, hey, maybe change your name, and then maybe a 24 hour, and then a 72 hour. And ArenaNet came out and said, no, the 72 hour was your warning.
That's awesome.
That's like, not that, a warning. That is the first ban. That's
no, 72 hours your warning. After that, if you continue doing that, you will get permanent banned, I'm guessing. But that yeah. they came out and said, like, no, that 72 hour ban, that was your warning.
But to me, that seems like a really fucked up three strike system.
I don't believe in a three strike system. I wish they just had warned the people outright before fucking banning them.
Yeah, I think banning someone for 72 hours is not right from the off-go, because you aren't going to get whatever you say about, you know, being mature and stuff. You know, welcome to the internet, welcome to an MMO game. You are going to get dumb people,
yeah, like
saying like holy fuck or
Sookee said there
like
was
that.
A dude named holy fucking wow. Like, there doesn't really seem to be a real standard.
Yeah, but
the
but
MMO
again
community.
Like using wow as the bar that you need to try to meet is kind of setting yourself
why not, because
real
it is the
low.
Big
the
MMO,
most popular
is it
MMO
not? Yeah,
no, it is,
I'm
but in terms of
one.
Community
fuck
it's one of the fucking worst.
Yeah.
It might be the biggest, most popular MMO, but it has one of the worst communities.
Yeah, but where do you go for the standard then? Like, where is sort of what
you
for
set
like
Lord of the Rings, which is what they're doing.
I mean, if nothing else, yeah. if you're gonna try to emulate a community from another game, Lord of the Rings is probably one of the better ones.
Yeah, but you don't set
and they
up,
and they
set
have
one
been
by not telling
stuff.
Anyone what the bar is and then banning people.
Well, how about this?
Who
it worked.
Your bar.
It worked really fucking well.
Yeah.
Well, I'm gonna go create a character called Holy Fuck right now.
Sure.
I'll do it. In, yeah, let's do this.
Let's all do it. Let's all.
And I'm totally happy they did it now. But I thought they could have done it better. But the example was set, and now most of those people are unbanned.
I do agree. If you decide to keep your name as Holy Fuck, by all means, ban them. But if the fact that they gave no warning whatsoever to
made
these
it more
people,
effective.
No, again, noob, they did. They responded back saying the 72-hour ban, that was their warning.
Yeah.
That's not a warning, though.
That's not a warning.
It is a warning.
Listen.
It's not a permanent ban. It's a 72-hour ban.
That is the bar that they are setting.
Yeah.
That is their bar. 72-hour ban, that's your warning.
Yeah, I like it.
You know, this is nostalgic of my homeland in North Korea, you know, where 2 years in the gulag is a warning.
Let's talk about the permanent ban. The permanent bans are
it
way more scary. Interesting because that I totally
okay.
So
Dante says the EULA has a warning. Yeah, but who reads the EULA?
That's not an argument in this case. They expect you to not be a jerk on the internet. I'm fine with that.
Yeah, I just well, why? Because everyone's a jerk on the internet.
Everyone's a jerk.
None of us did it, and we're fucking huge jerks. Like you spent half an episode
human warrior.
On the Germans.
You should be banned for human warrior. You
There's
be
lots
banned.
Of idiots on the internet.
Yeah, so tough luck. I don't give a shit if idiots get banned. What the fuck?
Yeah, exactly.
We'll
like,
teach them
like,
that.
Like that was
hey,
that was my, honestly like
that.
I don't even care if the guy listens to the podcast, but like the guy from Giant Bomb that put up that thread bitching about him getting the 72-hour ban for creating the character.
I didn't even
fuck,
click through there. I didn't even.
If you're listening. You deserve the ban. So
yeah, get
I don't
used
fucking
to it.
Care.
I think they should have given you a warning, and you should take this to court.
You
you'll
warning.
Totally win
you
the
cuddle.
Case.
I'll give you a cuddle if you come to England.
I don't think idiots need to be fucking mollycoddled.
If you, dude, if you all. Take this to court, you'll totally win $100 billion, guarantee it.
But yeah, yes, this is not interesting compared
I mean,
to the other ones.
Like
the permanent
I mean,
bans
I
are far
better. They do deserve bans, but I just think they could have presented it in a way better.
Understood.
Way.
Like we've gone
I
around
totally
circles
understand
now.
Your point
Noob
as well.
Stop.
Yeah, I understand.
Do you need this sort of conversation when your game's just launched, like of discussing whether ArenaNet are dickish or not?
Yeah,
like, do
why
you
not?
Need this?
Why not?
Because but, it's like
people have already bought their games. They've already sold it. I'm not stopping playing because some people, random people, got banned.
Yeah, but, like I'm not going to stop playing because a guy who decided to make an offensive name got banned. Like, if nothing else, good on them. Let's keep
I
going.
I honestly
yeah.
don't think
so,
it's
yeah,
bad press. I think it's good press because what Dourin said, the only people that really care and that are bitching about it now are the people that did it. And I don't know. I mean most of the people that do it are just, they deserve it. If you're not commonsensical enough to not do it, then you just kind of deserve it. and everybody else.
And it's not even just common sense. It's being inconsiderate because Guild Wars 2 is what? It's not even a 15 plus game. Is it 15 plus? Is it MA?
No,
it's an 18.
No. Wait, it's 18.
Yeah, so you're straight up being inconsiderate as well. Like, the kids playing the game are totally going to read your name, and straight up, if you're walking around with hell yeah N word, then
that's different.
Yeah, if you called that, then
yeah,
okay.
Because you could type that in, and they wouldn't have fucking censored it. So, like, straight up, I don't have any.
Wait, they don't have any censors whatsoever.
I didn't attempt it.
The funny part is, you guys laugh, but on Twitter, somebody did comment that one of the names that had gotten through and didn't get banned initially, but I'm guessing did shortly thereafter. Somebody did create a character named what was it? Nuckin' Figures.
What does that mean? I don't get it.
Flip the words. Think about it for a second.
Let's move on. So okay, so the other bands are more interesting by far.
The other bands were, like I said before, they were basically, there were karma weapons, that you could get. I think it was the ones in, I don't think it was ones in Lion's Reach.
It was in Lunar Reach. It's the human settlement. Ebonhawk. That's the one.
Ebonhawk. Yeah. There was a bug. They were selling for way, way lower than they should have. People that were going and a thousandth of what they should have been selling for. And so people were going through and buying them by the hundreds and either breaking them down, putting them in the Mystic Forge, basically making themselves godly or giving all this selling all this to other people to make money or whatever it is they were doing, clearly exploiting the game. And ArenaNet responded by giving those people permabans.
Just GG.
I'm fine with that.
It was fucking awesome.
Now, some people work in 72 hour if they had only done it to a lesser degree, and that was all determined by ArenaNet. It seemed like if it was like less than 100, then it was a 72 hour because there was a guy that had like 170 something, and he got a permaban.
Like, again, these are not people who are just buying one. These are people that are buying hundreds. If you bought one, who cares? But if you bought like hundreds of thousands.
There was a guy on the Reddit. He said he was permanently banned, and I think that's why Guild Wars 2 went back to it. Or, not Guild Wars, ArenaNet, because he was like, I bought like one, and I was permanently banned. He was saying, he basically stated his case saying, like, I didn't know they were supposed to only cost that much.
That's fine.
Well, if it's the same guy that I was thinking of, there was one that said he bought one, and then ArenaNet came back and said, no, you actually bought 172.
Oh my god. Oh. GG.
Oh god. I love that guy.
There's so many of those cases. Like, oh, I didn't do anything.
I don't know, but I do remember.
They're so transparent about this stuff, and that's why they.
If they did make a mistake, that would be fucked. But if, like, for the people who are buying hundreds, like, fuck yeah, ban them.
I'm sure they came back and were like, yeah, actually, we checked your account and we'll reduce your ban.
Yeah, that's fair as well. That's fair as well. Sometimes shit falls through the cracks, but like, the cool thing was. Like, straight up, this karma vendor was in Ebonhawk, and just the day before, Guildies walked up to it, and it was the seriously max level, awesome looking gear was only for 1k karma, and they're like, dude, you should just buy this. It looks so awesome, and it has awesome stats. So I was like, okay, yeah, sure. If it's 1k, then I'll come back to it like later. So I came back the next day. I went up to the karma vendor, and Sookee was with me, and we were just like. Hey, this is like 47,000 karma. I can't.
Yeah.
What the fuck? What the hell's happening? And then we go into Reddit, and then this straight up shit was broke, and people were just abusing the hell out of it. It's seriously, because the auction house isn't up, and that's like a huge part of this, right? Like, what are you guys' feelings on that? Like, do you guys think that is a huge implication of like why these people did what they did?
Because it wasn't up? No.
I think these people did this because they saw an opportunity to make a bunch of money or to get themselves really amazing gear.
But how do they make money from it?
People will find
selling it to vendors.
Yeah, they were straight up like selling it to vendors for
at least worth
like,
a golden or a silver and a half. That's quite a bit.
And when you're able to buy like 1,000 of them or something,
yeah,
they threw in the Mystic Forge as well, and you get better gear from that.
If you've saved up like 10,000 karma and you went in and did that, like, can you imagine how much money you can make off of that?
Like, by all means, ban those fucking people, because there's a difference. I'm not going to mention the last part, but it just, if you're going around buying 100,000 of these, you clearly know that you're exploiting the game.
Because apparently some guy was streaming it. He was streaming it.
Oh, yeah, that guy.
Yeah, there was a guy on Twitch
called... And he sort of told everyone.
Yeah, there's a guy on Twitch called Kriparian who streams a lot of stuff, and he had like over 1,000 people watching him while he was doing it, showing them how to do it, and live on stream got banned.
Awesome. That's the best.
And he's been permanently banned as well. Yeah.
But I hope they come to their house and kill his family too.
ArenaNet did come back afterwards, about a day or so later, and say that they were, you know, they wanted to put out a message that, you know, exploits are not going to be tolerated. If you find an exploit, you know, tell them about it. Don't abuse it. And they felt like that message had been properly, you know, received. And so they decided that this one time, anybody who got a permaban could petition to drop it down to a 72-hour ban. And like I described earlier, basically have to get rid of all the shit they got from it. And if they don't, then they will continue to be permabanned.
Yeah.
So they are doing this one this one time, but this doesn't mean that the next time there's an exploit that you can exploit it, get a permaban, and expect to roll it back. They said that they will never do that again. This is the one time they're rolling it back.
I love it. I love it.
I feel this is how they should do it, though, because I'm totally with you guys to say that they should ban those people because they're clearly exploiting the game. But if they fuck up, if ANET just, you know, messes up and the vendor's not working or there's bugs in the game, then I don't think you should get permabanned for it, even if you're exploiting it. Because there's probably people that just didn't know.
They thought it was it was.
Well, the
really
question
cheap,
was is was that just one item was 21 or the entire vendor list was 21?
One item was 21. What? 21 what?
One item was
no, because 21. Was the vendor only selling one item that was 20?
No, he's selling a bunch of items.
Right, and was that only one item? Was there only
cost
one
21
item? 21
karma.
All of them were cost 21 karma.
Yeah.
No. Only that item cost 21.
And the rest cost like 1,000 karma.
I guess.
So people could clearly tell, like, oh fuck, everything else cost 6,000.
Yeah,
this
but
one
how?
Item.
Like, it's the game's just launched.
So that's what I'm saying. Like.
How would you be able to tell?
If you buy 100 of them, I'm sure you realize.
Yeah, that's the thing. If you bought one, you know, because it was fairly cheap, or maybe even a couple because they were cheap, because you were maybe, you know, messing with it or whatever, like you probably didn't get any kind of a ban. And if you bought, like, say, 10 or 15 or maybe 20 to try to get the best one you can get through Mystic Forge or something, that's probably going to get you the 72 hour. But no, these people who bought 100 and hundreds and up to 1,000 of them,
and then
they clearly knew what they were doing.
Told people about it.
Yeah, like those people clearly knew what they were doing. They knew what they were doing was wrong, and they deserved their ban.
Yeah, they deserve their ban. But like, do you think like this is the right approach for every single exploit? Like, say in one of the arenas, you know, you like jump on a rock and you know,
it's not like abusing an exploit is going to immediately earn you a permaban. It is going to be the degree of the abuse of the exploit. Even in this case, not all people were given permabans. It was only those who very, very clearly took it to the extreme.
I'll admit, I've exploited this game once, and I feel very bad, and I reported it.
Did you buy 17,000 karma?
What was it? I'm interested. What was this?
No, it was a renowned heart where you had to disarm mines. Mm-hmm. And basically disarming one mine, you have to sit there for like 5 seconds disarming it. But if you switched your weapons midway, it immediately disarmed it.
We're streaming it.
And then I did it as quickly as I can and reported it so no one else could do it except me.
Oh, that's more of a game. See, I think the major difference here is that is a gameplay bug, which can be exploited to some extent, but it's still only gameplay. The problem with the
you can't ban people for that.
That's fine. The Ebonhawk thing is that the problem with that was it's an actual economic problem. Like, literally, those people have had permanent, far-reaching effects on the overall game economy. So they're literally fucking up everyone. And that's
the difference. Created non-existent gold out of nowhere.
Yeah, exactly.
Even if the trading post was down.
They've superseded what arena expectations were for the economy this close to launch. Like, straight up, you done fucked up. You did a bad thing. Even to the case where a single person who didn't think it was an exploit, doing it just to get himself rich... first of all, they rescinded it this time round, which is cool. So that person who wasn't expecting to be this harshly moderated can be put back. But it's sending a greater reaching message of, like, straight up, if you find a get-rich-quick scheme and you think it might be an exploit, don't do it. At least report it first.
Yeah, maybe take a couple that wouldn't ban you, but then report it.
Then report it, and then if nothing happens, well, then get rid of Squish.
And like Grom in chat says, one of the biggest reasons for this with the economy is gold does have a real money value in this game.
Excellent point. Excellent point. Because what if those same people bought like a shitload of crap on the gem store with the gold they made?
Exactly. Yeah. That's straight up money that ArenaNet is losing.
Yeah. Which is cool. That's pretty much all we have to say. So is there anything else you want to touch on? This seems like a good move.
Right. I think it's completely befitting, and I really like that they're overturning bans for some people. I don't think they should overturn it for that live streaming guy, but for like the people okay, good.
They will.
Who have sinned, but they're
no, because they have to. Doesn't he have to message rejected? In and say?
He has to contact their support and put in basically a petition to have it lowered or whatever. And he'll do that because he is like one of the biggest MMO live streamers on Twitch.
It's been terminated.
ArenaNet have confirmed on Reddit. Let's clear this up. Crypt's account is terminated.
Awesome.
Really?
GG.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow, they will not let him come back. Wow.
At the same time, I don't think people can blame it just on the exploiters. It's still partly ArenaNet's fault, irrelevantly.
Fucking up.
I don't think people... it's definitely their fault and they should be banned. Just don't,
but all exploits don't are
say,
the developer
oh, it's not,
up.
It's not ArenaNet's fault. It's those bad people.
Yeah, it's true. But like, literally every exploit is the developers fucking up. Like, ever.
Yep.
So, I will say, they did ban him. He's already bought a new account and he's playing again.
That's fine.
Well, okay.
Sure. So at least they made him go spend
more
money.
That's fine. So I guess we can move on. That was the news for the week. I don't think there is anything too huge. Do you guys want to talk about the auction house and what's happening with that? I want to inform people.
Shut the fuck up. Auction house.
Sorry,
really?
The trading
Nothing
post.
Is happening with it.
Really?
The trading post. Wait, I at least a, want to inform people post? About how
right, okay,
that's going.
Okay, so basically, the ArenaNet bourgeoisie up in Seattle decided to limit the trading post when after it went down to 25% of the population, and then
it was
the rest
15
of the
70- initially.
It was 15, right? And then 85%. They it wasn't equal. It was just unfair. So, we've started an organization called Occupy.
Oh God damn it! You started off so well. You started off so well.
Okay. No. So basically, the trading post went kapoo. It went up for a little bit near launch, and then it just fucking crashed. And at first, it came up with an error like DNS 502. It was just completely immersion breaking, as Dourin would say.
they banned their own trading post.
Yes, and then they put up a nice hours. Little disgusting frogman.
Oh, it was the most adorable thing.
Yes, so adorable.
And then they added the lion with the construction cap.
Yeah, which was cool. Which
The lion.
And then basically, so they have been they put up like a small test group for the. Trading post, they've been switching around of around 15%, so they would swap 15% of the population every couple of hours, I believe.
And now it's 25.
Yeah, now they're about
to 25, and I believe it's 50 now.
Is it 50 now? Okay.
I think it's 50. I'm assuming they're slowly increasing the population, so as many people have access to it slowly.
I like that.
Yeah, but without the trading post and when the mail went down, trading is literally impossible.
The mail system going down
kind of emphasized how ridiculous it is that there is no personal trading in this game.
And that is a fucking huge flaw, and I sincerely hope reporters, or not reporters, what am I saying? Video game
reviewers,
journalists, reviewers actually talk about that, because like you can argue that, sure, it's MMO launch, but that's just being an
apologist.
Well,
it's kind of interesting, because like the process of them fixing things after the MMO launch was interesting to me. Like really cool, because like just not that it was good that they had to fucking fix so much so after launch. It was just like their processes or their thought processes of what was their priority list was very evident when you saw how they approached this. Because when the game first came out, the first thing that was fucking completely broke was partying and the guilds, right? Those are the two like number one with the bullet point things that was broke. Then was trading post. And was there anything else the major that they fixed? Was it zones? No, zones were still fine.
According to Tumbleton, they took down mail because people were cloning stuff.
Yeah. So what happened was the first thing they absolutely fixed was the party system, and which is kind of really cool. Like, what do you guys think about that? What do you guys think about their process?
Oh man, having done Ascalon Catacombs before they fixed it, and the second dungeon too. Yeah. Oh fuck. That problem was existent in the beta weekends, and I was really surprised
that
problem was not fixed.
That
come
happening,
on.
that happening, I was just like, this was an issue back in the beta. How the fuck do you launch your MMO with dungeon and partying not working?
I just ran across a bunch of bugs that were existing in the beta, but it's easy to assume that, you know, they clearly had not enough time for these things because they had other stuff to fix. But then again, like, come on, man.
Well, the rapidity of these being fixed is pretty cool, but I love the fact that the first thing they fixed was for people to play together, which is awesome.
Yeah.
So they fixed partying. Yeah. And the second thing they went for, I think pretty much after many fixes to the stability of the game for a bunch of people, login servers for a bunch of people, party system for a bunch of people, even though that's gone in and out. And then they got to the trading post. I think it was like, 3 days after the game went live, they started fixing the trading post?
And most importantly, they still have yet to bring the forums up at all because they feel like getting people playing the game is number one. Like, the forums are a secondary thing. They don't want to pull people off to mess with that stuff or to put more server stress or anything like that. They're saving that for complete last after the game is stable.
It's good to say that, like, even though we had a bunch of errors, the one thing for me that wasn't never really errored was the game itself. Like, I played the game.
I get disconnected very much.
Yeah.
In fact, the only time I got disconnected was when it went down, and that was, like, for 4 hours, and I was asleep for most of that. So I didn't find big problems
And even the better thing was, even though I've had, like, one or two disconnections, except for one time, I didn't lose any progress at all. It was crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like how they're doing a lot of the stuff behind the scenes. Like, we're basically, when you hit a patch of lag, which seems out of the blue, it's usually because ArenaNet are working on the servers. Like, they're doing a lot of behind-the-scenes.
Yeah, how weird is that? It's like suddenly things start upgrading in the guild panel. I'm like, oh, right, yeah, they're doing maintenance. And that's it. And I can still play the game, but just like slight little things are...
Yeah, like the worst that you get is a 20 to 60 minute downtime.
Right.
Like, as somebody who has played a lot of WoW and has dealt with their 4 to up to 12 hour maintenance times, this is absolutely amazing. Like, this is like magic.
Dourin, Guild Wars 2 really launch versus Diablo 3 magical. Launch, go.
What's that?
Guild Wars 2 launch versus Diablo 3 launch, go.
All that.
Guild Wars 2 is playable.
How about Star Wars?
Though both have the trading posts down.
Yeah, so. Both have the trading posts down, but the login problems were just fucking...
Could you trade in Diablo without...
No.
Or is there no trading whatsoever?
You could drop stuff on the ground.
You can drop stuff on the ground.
You could trade.
That's like RuneScape.
You could trade. You could open up a trade window with somebody, so never mind.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, direct trade. But in this, you could... For a lot of the time, mail was working. Like, mail was working for a lot of the pre-trading post going down.
But there's no, legitimate way of trading with, like...
Yeah, it is a little annoying, when you're in a dungeon and everybody gets their gear because everybody gets their own gear in this game, similar to Diablo 3. Right. So then everybody just kind of links everything into chat, and then you kind of pick out what you want from who. And then you got to mail it off to that person. Like, that's just, it's
or
so
if you want to just buy stuff from people, there's no typing into places. You
yeah, because well, that's the other thing too.
It's a gamble. Like, will this person send me the money? Or
yeah, they're not being a trade. There is no fucking COD option.
Yeah.
Like, that is just mind boggling.
It's ridiculous. I don't know. It's ridiculous.
I agree entirely. Like, the straight up not being a comparative trade window is something they have to put in. And I believe they said they will put it in. It's kind of crazy that it didn't make launch. But I think the mail system is a good sending system at the moment. A lot of people don't know the quick shortcuts to use it. Like, for example, if you click on someone in game, just straight up on the character model, and their health bar comes up, their portrait on the right hand side of that, all you have to do is right click that and hit mail to.
And mail to.
If you're in the same party, you can just right click the portrait on the left hand corner of your screen and hit mail to. If you're in the same guild, you can just hit G, find the name just by quick searching it, and then right click mail to. Like, there's just a lot of ways to quickly.
You can also just right click on the item in your inventory and say send a mail or whatever.
Oh, but then you have to type it in a mail.
If you've been conversing with the people before, you just hit reply on the mail.
Yeah, that's pretty cool as well.
Yep.
But the lack of trade is a thing.
Fuck no trade. That is still no trade for me because I haven't gotten the trading post once.
But
it's a conspiracy. It's an ArenaNet conspiracy
post-launch.
To make sure I don't enjoy this game.
They just want to make sure you. They just want to make sure you're not our top cook. That's all it is.
Oh, you got owned. It's Nibrama. We could transition to.
No, keep on talking about bugs. There were two bugs which prevented me from 100%ing maps. That pissed me off.
This is not something to talk about on a podcast.
Wait, I think there's one thing that I'd like to add to the discussion before we switch. They actually stopped selling the game.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah, good point.
What?
Good point. What?
Yeah, so they stopped selling digital copies of the game through their website in order to relieve stress on servers.
Well, the normal kind of one.
Yeah, the normal one. You could buy the digital deluxe.
No. They stopped selling
all digital copies.
All you can get is the collector's edition. You can still order that, okay. But everything else is locked.
You sure? Somebody
bought the digital one.
Well, yeah, you had to buy the digital deluxe one. Well, maybe now they've taken everything down, but
I just checked and it didn't work.
Okay.
All right, so yeah, the point was just the German site.
Not America.
I think it was
not
2 days America. Ago that they said, hey guys, we know there's a bunch of server issues and we know people are struggling to play the game. So what we're going to do is, if it's going to continue to be a problem, we're going to bring down the digital sales of the game. And then they did. How do you guys feel about that?
Good for people, not very good for business.
Well, it is good for business because, like, they would rather kind of lose the maybe some sales they could be getting right now. While they fix these server problems, than to lose people because the game becomes unplayable and they decide to say fuck it to this game and go play something else.
Yeah, I think
they're already getting
Well, Jimmy, what's your thought on this?
Yeah, I agree with Dourin. I think anyone who's going to buy it digitally and at the crazy price that they're selling at digitally, in my opinion,
for you, not for anyone else.
That's all of Europe.
Well, I think you can still get it cheap. Like in America, I'm sure you can still get it cheaper. Like there's still plenty of ways to get Guild Wars 2. Plenty of cheaper and better ways to get Guild Wars.
But then I have to walk out of my house. Why?
Well, no, because if you get a retail copy, it's going to be $60. It's not cheaper anywhere else.
Like can you still buy it digitally?
You might be able to get it through Green Man Gaming, but that's going to be a digital one, which means that you probably can't buy it through Green Man Gaming.
Not for a while.
Well, I saw it in a shop for me that was like £36.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, that doesn't happen here in America. Our prices are very games are $60.
Yeah,
okay. That's why Steam is so amazing here.
Right, but so yeah, people can still pick it up, just not the digital version.
Yeah, there's still plenty of ways to get it.
Yeah. And that's like
guilds were so broken.
I think it was a lot of. It showed a lot of balls on their part. Like, they straight up said, they looked at it and went, well, we care about the people who are currently playing the game. I know that sounds like artsy-fartsy, but that's how it sounded when they said it. And straight up, like, we will stop future purchases, and we'll slow down future purchases in order to ensure a good gaming experience. And I think that, again, for people who play the first Guild Wars, we can attest that, like, this is an example of stuff we experienced for those, like, 5 or 6 years, or the 3 or 4 years that I played it. Like, Arena generally does stuff by the current consumer, a lot. And that's a lot of their modus operandi, and I think it's awesome.
The last MMO that was willing to take this step was WoW. Like that was the last MMO that actually like stopped selling copies for a while to get servers.
Well, the Old Republic limited how many they pre-sold. They were like,
They said they were going to limit how many they pre-sold, but they continued pre-selling them up to the last day.
Well, maybe they just didn't hit the expected
pre-sale. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like they said they were going to limit it if they got to a certain point, and they never got to that point.
Wah, wah. All right, we can move on.
What about guilds?
Oh, yeah, guilds would work. Probably build. Okay, so
if I open up the guild tab, my FPS goes to 5. How? Why?
Mine fixed. Like, mine isn't doing that anymore. I don't know.
Mine did that the second I was playing.
Well,
like,
can you run us through the process was, Noobarama, for the Giant Bomb guilds? And Dourin, because you both were involved.
So, yeah, but basically what how it started was, so at first, day one, or at least the first 12 hours of Guild Wars 2 being up, is invites were working fine. We started up the guild. We started sending out invites we had on the roster. And then I woke up, and then people were like, okay, so we got our entire thing roster filled up. So we were allowed to now have people just request if we can invite people. And what turned out to be happening is when we invited them, they'd get the pop-up, like, you've gotten the invitation to Lincoln Force Bomb, and they would not be able to see any invite.
Yeah. Well, they'd click
and
it, or it
was
didn't
happening
do nothing.
For any,
or...
Right. They just did nothing. Yeah, the join button didn't work, etc. Apparently there was a fix to relog, but that didn't work for some people.
Or I think Arena said there was a fix that you can, like, accept from a world versus world server.
Right.
That was hilarious.
Yeah. So what happened then, Dourin?
So then we created a second guild. We created How I Met Your Mesmer.
That was such a good name. Such a good name. How Met Your Mesmer.
Really good name. yeah, CBSI for our tag. And kind of created that as an overflow guild, invited everybody who wasn't able to get into the initial Giant Bomb guild, got our numbers up to like 200 in that second guild before we finally were able to merge them after the guild stuff was fixed.
So to what extent was it fixed?
Only when we merged the stuff, only two of us could invite. Me and Chav were the only one with invites.
It didn't
work for Robbie.
I actually had to pull him and Chav over into the second guild, give them invite privileges in that guild, and we did the inviting that way. Because Robbie still, I think to this day, still cannot invite in our guild.
I'm not sure if I can invite at the moment.
We've got the touch. We've got the power. As I sang while I did that.
But it was a tremendous amount of work. Like, so to what extent is guild fixed? Like, does everything fine now?
It seems like it seems like at this point everything is fixed. Everybody who was in How I Met Your Mesmer has gotten an invite to Lincoln Force. Yeah. Last I checked in How I Met Your Mesmer, there were only like three people still representing. So I'm guessing that's a good thing, and that means that everybody has transitioned over. I'm probably going to double check back with that guild, with anybody who's still representing, just to make sure.
Right. If you're listening right now and you're still in How I Met Your Mesmer, do send me a message in-game or something like that.
And I did create a thread kind of outlining how all that went, and if you have any issues to report them or whatever, and we would go ahead and invite. But no, it seemed like everything went fairly smoothly. Like the merging process was way faster than I expected.
Yeah, it was fixed really quickly.
Right, and then I can represent people all of a sudden, or I can represent the guild all of a sudden. Yeah. You had that problem too, right?
Oh, dude,
Dourin?
Yeah, yesterday.
I had that problem. I closed the client out and reopened it, and I was fine.
Yeah, like some people logged in and they just couldn't. They just weren't in the guild on their guild tab,
there was that too. I think they attempted to fix the guild, but then like they broke it even further. So a lot of us that were in Lincoln Force suddenly showed as not in Lincoln Force, even though we actually still were. But that only lasted for like a day, and then that got fixed.
Yeah,
For all I'm bitching about the game, the overall thing was okay. It was pretty good.
Yeah, where the state of that stuff is now, like the guild is good. Like we are, everything seems to be working pretty well. There's a couple of you that seem like you still don't have invite capabilities for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm.
But at least everyone is in the guild who wanted in the guild. We started getting more requests for invites, and we're starting to kind of creep up on the cap.
We're 380 something.
We're at like 416 now.
Oh, jeez. So can you just quickly state, because I want to move on, because this is just talking about our guild. In general, I also want to state that these are problems that affected all guilds towards launch. And again, it was really shitty for the first couple of days, but they pretty much fixed most of it by now, which is good. So can you just quickly hit on what we're going to do going forward with Lincoln Force, and then I want to move topics.
Yeah, so quickly, going forward with Lincoln Force, if you want an invite to the guild, we are not doing invites directly in-game, so if you whisper us in-game and ask for an invite, we're probably just going to redirect you to the forums and tell you to post your information there.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason we're doing that is because we are already at, looks like Zyber in chat, so we're actually up to 450 now. So we're coming very, very close to that cap. We want to make sure that Giant Bomb dudes get in before anyone else. We're not pulling random people in before them. So if you post your stuff in the forums, say that you want to invite it to the guild, then we'll go ahead and get you the invite then. If we end up hitting the cap of 500 and still have people wanting in, we're going to actually just use How I Met Your Mesmer as an overflow guild.
Yeah.
So if you're still wanting in, we'll definitely get you in, at least into that guild. And the kind of long-term goal here is to find a system where if somebody is inactive for a fairly lengthy period of time, we would like to basically kick them from the main guild, but at the same time send them an invite to the overflow, so the active players are constantly the ones that are in Lincoln Force.
Yeah. That has to do with influence, just making sure the right people play together. Like, don't feel bad if you get moved to How Many Mesmer. We can always move you back. It's just that, we want to keep Lincoln Force an active guild. It's as simple as that. And I want to move on. Yeah. So
we should have, like, these games called the Hunger Games. And we should have them a fight to the death for every guild member, whoever gets, whoever
we
wins.
We need a crazy love.
Oh my god! Can you believe how many guild members are over level 70? Oh no!
There's only ridiculous. Or at least over level 50.
No, over 60. Over 60. Sorry, over 60.
There's only like 10.
That's 10 people over level 60.
That's still a lot.
Big deal. I'm a part of the 10.
That's huge. That's so many.
How many is it?
I think it's like 10.
Me and Sookee are in the 10.
Also over 16.
Silent Dante and Soul are like 75 or whatever. I don't even know anymore.
I felt like I was playing a lot of this game and I'm still only like 40.
Same.
You know what, Dourin? I have some advice for you. L2P. L2P. Learn to play.
And now we can move on to what we've actually been playing in Guild Wars 2.
We've been playing Guild Wars 2. Oh my god, Guild Wars 2 came out.
Guild Wars 2 came out, guys. Holy shit.
What the fuck?
Oh my god. So I want to split this out into two separate parts. One half I'm going to do personal story, and then we're going to bring it home in dungeoneering. So I will state up front here that if you're worried about spoilers, don't listen to this podcast. Like, you can stop here.
Oh, can I talk about spoiling?
To some extent. I'll outline that after in a bit.
Logan Thackeray dies.
High five. That's
awesome. I hope he dies.
You kill Logan Thackeray at some point.
I hope.
Yes.
Anyway. And then you teabag his face. Yeah, you teabag his face. That's a mini game.
So I will say that we'll probably be spoiling. Let's just say we'll spoil up to level 30.
And then up to level 70.
And we'll also be spoiling a lot of the dungeons. Like, we will literally just go through dungeon strategies towards the end of this game, this podcast, because I definitely want to talk about that, the awesomeness we did in those dungeons. If you're not planning to do the dungeons, or you want to have some idea of the dungeon before going through, which I recommend you do, because they can be pretty damn difficult, then keep listening. But if you're really worried about spoilers, then you can tune out now. There are other podcasts out there for people who don't want to know these. So check out Tales of Tyria, for example, or Guildcast. Anyway, so with that, let's start with personal story.
You just helped our competitors.
I don't.
What kind
consider
of
them our competitors? Our compatriots.
How's their competition in a place where like no money is made?
Yeah.
Like, what is the competition?
The competition for fame and prestige of the Guild Wars 2 podcasting world.
So I want to start talking about personal story, right? Four of us are human, and one of us is Savari, right? That's crazy. That's just absolutely batshit.
I'm a Char.
No, he's Char.
Oh, yeah, you're Char.
Remember, he went to Char.
Yeah. Well, what level are you
furry
at the moment?
21.
So do you mind if we go up to level 30 stuff, or should we just talk about the starting stuff? I don't mind either way, because both stuff's pretty cool.
It's fine. Okay. It's fine. Don't worry.
Cool.
Well, the starting stuff is like beta stuff.
Well, yeah, so like you have, because everything starts pretty much the same way, right? Like, because for me, it was this is the first time I did the human starting stuff. And the thing that surprised me the most was that it was actually incredibly engaging. Like,
oh man, they redid the armor for the Seraph.
It doesn't look like shit now. It's kind of cool. Like,
they don't all look like Logan Thackeray.
Before, like, the females were like in this beautiful radiant armor, and the dudes were just fucking just slouches,
fat slobs, like militiamen.
And now they have like,
you've
this
been
sweet
called
Seraph
up to
armor.
Fight. Oh, okay.
Well, so, Dourin, what have you been up to in your personal? How much have you done of it? Your personal story.
I think I'm up to, oh man, where am I at? Like level 39 is where my current one is.
Mm-hmm. No, that's pretty decent. So you've already met the orders.
Yes, I've joined the priory.
Awesome. I just want to quickly get a feel for where everyone is. Sookee. Where are you up to now in your personal story? You're up to level 40 something, right, or 50?
No, I caught up on it a little bit, and I think I'm up to 59 right now.
Whoa! And Noob, you're up to 60?
62.
Jesus Christ. I'm only up to level 36 on my personal story. No, 43.
It's a good way to level, and it's actually really fun and exciting.
So how does it...
Man.
And just to round it out, zoom around me, where are you up to in your personal story?
41.
that one. That one's really good. So what
level just 19, but then I've been spending time. I did the Asura starting area because I was a bit underleveled.
Oh, yeah.
I've not been focusing on the personal story.
That is...
Take these leveling pills.
Totally
I'll
valid.
Sell you really cheap.
Because remember, the game's out now.
I got an email about some pills, actually. Some level that will help me grow.
Level in a different way.
What? Go downstairs. Does it work? Does those work?
What?
What downstairs? Oh god! What the fuck?
I mean,
what are you thinking, man? What are you going to email
about?
Something
went purple.
It went purple for a few days, and then fell off. So I don't think they work very well.
God. Just literally popped off.
I just woke up and it was gone. Like, I had no.
And it was just lying there between my legs, and it was just weird. It was just at this weird moment of disconnection.
I just had a patch of skin there instead. I don't know what where it's gone.
Are you still?
And then he just shrugged and logged into Guild Wars 2.
Some of my boxes were gone as well. It must have just taken off, I guess.
You wear boxers? That's fucking disgusting.
What's wrong with boxers?
What?
Why are you in tighty whities?
No.
What are you wearing right now?
Superman underwear?
I don't wear anything.
Okay.
What are you wearing now?
I'm a nudist. I was going to say I wear a thong, but I guess realized that's probably grosser than wearing a boxer.
Well, you literally just said it, so it doesn't matter
now,
does it?
So, I want to start with Dourin.
Yeah, where's your first
I want to start with Dourin. What was your personal story so far? Like, what choices have you made? Like, have you felt it's been... Like, just tell me it.
Oh, God. I'm going to say probably start with somebody else because I don't remember all of the choices other than joining the Priory.
Noob?
Yeah, me neither, scumbag. Pretty much. I mean, there's not many more. Like, how many choices are there?
Yeah, really? I think there's maybe been three.
So,
up to that point.
I've made like two choices in mind.
Yeah, the major one was like, did you guys minor. Save the orphanage or the old people's home or whatever it was?
Orphanage.
That's different to yours. I don't think I had an orphanage one.
Yeah, that's only for the human one.
I saved the orphanage.
I'm pretty sure I didn't. Save anything.
Oh wait, Cynic, you did the sister one, right?
Didn't save anything.
I did the sister one.
I did the sister one too, and I don't remember that one.
Wait.
It might be either the pauldrons or.
No, you're right. It was orphanage, or what was the other option?
Veterans hospital, some shit.
No, just hospital. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No. I saved the orphanage.
Specifically veterans hospital because it was.
Whatever, doesn't matter.
It was orphanage because otherwise you're an evil person.
you can't kill kids.
And the kids love you, and then you get some. You know what? Never mind.
What?
You don't get anything.
What'd you get? What'd you get, noob?
Then you put them pills to good use.
Satisfaction.
Sweet satisfaction.
Nice.
Satisfaction.
I think it's really telling that a bunch of us don't really remember too much before the because I actually think it really picks up.
I remember all of it.
So, tell me your personal story, Nick. Go ahead.
So, I'm a humble, you know, average commoner. Mm-hmm. I'm friends to Petra and some other dude who got sick.
Okay, you now remember and, 10 times more than I remember. Go on.
All right. So, basically, I picked the Conqueror's Pauldrons because they didn't look ugly.
What was the what's the backstory for those?
Which one? It's just like, what the fuck? Where are you getting pauldrons? I don't care. I don't know.
They look pretty good.
So, basically... The kind of thing, the shape, the personal story made in terms of like how it diverged was like an hourglass where, it was the starting areas would be, or the starting couple of missions would be dependent on what you picked. So it's different from everyone else's.
Mm-hmm.
And then it diverges into, you know, the general route of, Vigil. And then you get, once you get to the choice of Vigil, Priory, and, what's the third one? Order of Whispers, it splits off again. So it meets together at one point, and once you get that choice, it splits off again. And I think I got back to the meetup point for the choices.
Right.
And man, are there a lot of fucking choices. I did not expect this from an MMO.
It's pretty cool.
So even in the beginning, definitely the story's a lot slower, and you don't feel like you don't realize like you're a part of a bigger story right now.
Yeah.
So it's mostly dealing with like your race.
You straight right. up, the way they describe it is like you meet your. Races avatar from Destiny's Edge,
who is a fucking scumbag
in our case, because Logan Thackeray is a son of a bitch,
which is unfortunate.
I was totally a Logan Thackeray apologist when I read the book, because I would have done what he did. I'm not sure what I would have done in that situation.
Like, he yells, "What would you have done in your situation?" Something about the woman he loves or whatever.
Yeah,
fuck, I don't care.
It's fucking bullshit. And then you see him in game, and he's just the biggest whiny fucking piece of crap, shitty.
You don't understand.
And Jenna is not pretty. Like Queen Jenna.
Yeah, I think she's pretty.
She's okay.
No, she's pretty.
She's all right.
I beg her up, and then tie her up, and then tell her shut up. But then again, she's a mesmer, so she could probably outpower me. I don't know.
Probably grabbed an illusion or something.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. And then it just pops.
Yeah, then it just explodes.
Yeah, then you die. Then you die immediately.
As long as it lasts for 2 seconds, I'm A-okay.
Yeah, days. No, I have saved yourselves. God, this is terrible nerdy jokes.
You make choices at early levels. I don't know.
Right, you make choices. So So it you feel like, you know, you're definitely a hero, but in a smaller area. You're a hero of the human race rather than a hero of Tyria.
Yeah.
But once you...
It's still quite a big thing.
So not even really human race. Choice,
it's more like you're just kind of a human or a hero of, like, Divinity's Reach.
Well, where the fuck else are there humans in Tyria?
Well, I mean, I guess, but...
Yeah. Yeah, exactly,
Dourin. You're a hero. You're making it sound much bigger than it is. Like, you're a hero of a town.
Oh, dude, they constantly, the capital city of
everyone
the
knows
human
you
race.
For some reason.
Yeah, everyone, you're the hero of Shaymor, yeah, like, even after you did the intro.
What the fuck does that even mean? What the fuck does that even mean? I stood there for, like,
remember,
a minute,
yeah,
beating on this hat, and hands, and then suddenly.
I can guarantee I wasn't the fucking only hero of Shaymor. People must be getting tired. Oh, he's the.
Oh, you're the other hero of Shaymor. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, the one with the brown hair. Yeah. Okay. So it's. You definitely have some sort of importance, but not to the grandness of some sort of other MMOs. But once you get through the last choice, so your sister died, your circus, blah, 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 and you get to the end of those missions, it picks up into the actual story, like defeating the dragons and fighting them off.
What level is that?
That's about level 20. That 20 was the end mission for the sister thing.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Your sister doesn't die. Oh, they decided to go the happy ending route, and she's alive.
Yeah, I know. That's what route I took.
That was so dumb.
I think I'm saving my dad or something.
But
it's with my dad in this one, not my sister.
I don't even remember my sister's name anymore.
She's so, did you see her once?
Deborah.
Literally, your character has lost his sister to the centaur threat. Like, she was like...
Was she hot?
She's like an older sister.
Oh, dude, having the name Deborah. The protagonist Deborah. Is the best in speak or in text conversations. It's like, hey, look, it's the protagonist. it's the fucking greatest
thing. I hate
name.
You. I wish I got that name.
It's so great.
The sister has been lost to the centaur threat. And for what you can tell to be at least months, I don't know. Like, your character doesn't really seem to have a big statement of how long he's lost his sister for. And then you find her in a center war camp, and it's
for
like,
how long? Like, she might have been in there for 8 years.
No, it was a bandit camp.
It was a bandit camp.
You don't know her sentence.
So she's there, and
she's there.
And you just talked to her like once.
That was quite possibly the worst, Zumi. The worst. That's saying something coming from you.
Okay. And then there's this fucking great scene where it's like, all right, I guess. And then you finish that, and then you talk about dragons, right? You get a mail from whatever, or I don't even remember anymore. You're right.
Some other person.
Fuck that. Yep. It's because it's unimportant. And then you're like, all right, so you go to a gathering place. Oh, no. You meet up with a vigil representative. You know, like the representative of the three big groups. So basically, you finish that, and then it's like, I'd like you to meet some people. And then so they're talking about defeating
this
the
prison. Your home. How do you guys feel about the home instance, by the way? It's kind of cool.
It's kind of cool, but I wouldn't want to fucking hang out there other than cybering with sexy ladies on the internet.
But
it's kind of cool, but so far I don't really see the point. Bed.
Well, it's kind of like having a spot like where the NPCs can be, and it's contextual in the world, and there's like other NPCs there.
They should have a guild. Should perfectly probably have a guild instance kind of thing. That'd be pretty cool inside Divinity's Reach.
But yeah, but I actually think that the personal story, like the home is benefited by having a home instance, because you can literally have a spot where it's just you and the NPCs. And there's no like people just fucking running around. There's just someone jumping up and down inside Logan Thacker.
Yeah,
like,
no one saying stop cybering on global chat.
I see that. Yeah, that makes sense.
And you can like totally a lot of the stuff you do in your personal story, like personal instance, is actually making big decisions. And so you really have to you need time. Like you need. I stood there for a while thinking about which way I would go. For example, and we'll get there in a bit. But yeah. So Noob, keep going.
So you get three representative, and this is where more choices come in. So each mission has the option of choosing between one or the other, because you don't choose three of them at once. So two of them will come up and give you choices on what kind of mission it would be. So the Order of Whispers is very sneaky, like, say, going into disguise into a pirate camp to get what you want.
Right.
The Vigil is just head-on combat, and I don't fucking care what the Priory
is. The Priory is...
they want to fight the dragon with... using
knowledge,
superior technology,
technology.
So I went with the Vigil or the Whispers all the time because I always wanted to go to Vigil. And basically, so you have the option to choose what kind of mission you're going on. So if you choose, say, Whispers over Priory, you're going to get a completely different mission. It's going to be the same idea.
Like the first one was it's a different was way. The first of one, the undead, like the children being
yes, the undead, yeah,
yeah.
Children being rescued.
Which way did you guys swing on that? Because one of the things was that one was a Vigil versus Priory, or was it Shadows versus Priory? Because I picked Priory.
It was Vigil versus Priory.
Okay, so what did Vigil want to do?
They wanted to just... They already had sent in a group. Oh, no, they haven't. They just wanted to get in there
and save
those
kids. The
Vigil
wanted to do what the Vigil always wants to do, which is just send military dudes in and clean shit up.
And,
guess what? That's fucking option. Effective. That's effective. That's
like
effective.
America. I love it. The Priory is cool.
And the Priory wanted to be like, we'll test out this unfounded technology that could fucking kill the children, but hey,
and guess what?
Cares?
It worked.
It totally works.
Hey, guess what? Mine worked too. None of the children died.
Well,
right.
Snooki,
and you guys were
you're
cowards.
You're a Priory guy, right?
I'm a fucking hero.
Like, you tend to swing that way. So what?
You swing that way?
Did you?
My sexual preference is Priory.
What the hell choice is this?
Did you feel like you what they did in that mission informed your later choice to go with the Priory?
I guess I don't know. I just like
did you do it
the general
because
idea.
You're German and you wanted to be like the knowledgeable one, like the knowledgeable group, because you're German.
Most definitely, yeah.
It was because he was German. He didn't want to go the militaristic route.
This is the most efficient, and he just fucking goes.
This is the most.
You know, the
Vigil
on them.
Oh yeah, the Vigil. I swing that way for sure.
The Vigil really weren't an option, seeing as how they're the military. Guys, and you know,
what are you talking about?
Exactly, yeah.
And that was brought up bad memories of your early time in the wars.
Oh yeah,
no,
I
just feel
man in uniform.
So the Whispers, they're just too sneaky for me, and too backstabby.
By
the way,
sneaky.
Spies must die.
I really like the idea of just beating your enemies through knowledge and technology.
I'm sure you
and
do.
It kind of fits my character too, my Ellie. And right. I'm not a
guardian. I
want
to protect
really
people.
Into role playing, but the little I do, I guess, or just to help my immersion in general, I think it's just the right way to go. Also, they look cool. And an Azura talked to me, so that's the way to go. If there's an Azura,
plus they're like the only place where a dwarf exists. So why would you not pick them?
Yeah.
Oh, really? Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Oh,
there's one dwarf out in the world, and it is in the Priory.
So yeah, the undead mission plays out like there's kids who are like surrounded by fucking undead, and the one I played at the time was Priory because I was leaning towards that with like defending via knowledge, right. And like they have this like crazy device. Well, Nude, what happens in that mission?
Basically, mine is they sent out a smaller group to get the kids, but then they were surrounded. So basically, it was a rescue mission where we had to help bring them back right, and basically it was defending against waves and then cutting through an opening. Back out. So we cut through an opening back in, and we had to defend against a big wave, and then we came back out.
It's totally
no casualties. No casualties.
The Vigil
no
is awesome
behind.
Because it's really well. I'll get to why I went Vigil in a bit, but it seems to like their method is brute force, right? But
their motto is some must fight, so others may be free.
Yeah,
that's fucking. That's
like intense,
good.
Right?
I don't know.
Intense.
Yeah.
And their entire thing was like they. Like if you look at them, like you just look at them in face value, it seems like they're just like, oh, we'll just go in and kill things. But they're really, they're tactically sound. Like they're not stupid. Like they go in, they do the right thing
for the situation.
They're like spec ops. Yeah,
man, spec ops.
Yeah, they're not the general military. They're the specialist military. They're badass.
Oh man, Black Ops 2. So bad.
But like the
360 no scope as a Vigil.
So the Vigil go
the
in and like
Priory?
Totally like secure the children and then fight off the undead.
Yeah.
What's his face? The Priory goes,
and then there's totally a scene like, "Oh, I'm wounded, leave me behind," and you freaking take them back.
That's awesome.
You know what? No one left behind. Yeah. No one left
you know
behind.
What? Vigil, fuck you guys.
You got an emotional attachment to your comrades. And I'm going to talk about that later because there's totally an emotional attachment to your comrades.
So, Dourin, how did the Priory approach the situation?
The Priory one, you use this new device that they created based on Charr technology that. Allows the person holding it to like sense the undead but like make them invisible to the undead.
Yeah.
And so basically what you do is you kind of infiltrate your way around from child to child and give that to them, and then they basically run out of there.
It's kind of the most hilarious thing, because there's a little kid like lying there, and you go, "Little kid, I'll help you." And she's like, "What? Yeah, who the fuck are you?" And then she's and you're like, "No, it's fine. Just take this device. It'll make you invisible to the undead." And then they're like, what? "Okay, yeah. Mister."
What happens if the kid trips and drops it? Huh? Think of that. What then, Dourin? You're gonna
natural selection.
Put those kids.
Natural selection.
I mean, it's not like you assist them to come back like one at a time. You just like give it to them. They go, "Okay, Mister," and they just fucking bolt in the direction.
They're gone, and then you go to the next kid. I think I killed like one enemy the entire mission.
I realized how I play video games when I did that one, because that all you need to do was sneak from kid to kid and give them the machine. But I just fucking killed all the undead.
Coward.
I just killed everything.
What happens if they die? Okay.
I'm vigil, man. I'm vigil to the bone. Vigil. But at that time I didn't know. I thought the vigil was stupid at that time.
Stupid.
So go ahead, noob. After you defeat them. We're getting close to it. That was level 20, right?
Yep. Ish? Right. No, this is level 24. I would say 22, level 24, right? And then basically we're back, and then there's another choice. Do you remember what the next one was? Because is it the pirate one that was next, or was it?
Oh shit! Because it was between the Priory and the Whispers, right? Or was it with Vigil and Whispers? Yep. It was Vigil and Whispers.
That was Priory.
It was Vigil
and Whispers,
and there was like a town that was being attacked.
Right. So there's this town in Keswick Hills. It is where it's constantly being attacked by Crait beforehand, but now it's being attacked by Risen. And I believe the Whispers we'd sacrifice this town so we can hold them off later on. But the Vigil wanted to save the town, mm-hmm. like because they're
badasses.
We're not scumbags. Yeah, because, and we don't want people to die.
The
kind of
thing was like the Whispers are like, because there's like a dude who's summoning the undead. And the Whispers are like, we should find that dude and pinpoint him so you can take him out quicker and therefore save more people in the long run. And the Vigil was just like, fuck it, we're just going to save everyone. And we're just going to go into the town
and
hold it.
Guess who saved everyone? The Vigil.
They go into the town, they hold it against the enemy hordes, and barely anyone dies, and then they go off and kill.
Did the Vigil mission too?
Yeah, I did the Vigil in that one. Fuck the Whispers.
What about you, Dourin?
I did the Whispers, actually, in that one.
How did they do it? Because I have no idea how they did that one. So, like, what was their approach to that mission?
I'm trying to remember I think you went to, like... Oh God, I'm trying to remember. I think you went to like the town and you help like fight off the Risen, because the guy like won't tell you the information because they're being attacked and everything.
Okay.
And then like once they've been fought off, then like the guy, the main guy that you're trying to go after or whatever gets away, but you get the knowledge to find out that where he had come from, or whatever, and that leads you eventually then to the pirate mission. So it's kind of a similar mission structure.
Yeah,
that's
weird.
Except you let a village burn.
But it didn't, because it's kind of weird that they accomplished the same thing, but for a different like purpose.
Wait, no, but did you defend the village?
Yeah,
we went there for information, but we had to fight the stuff off to get the information.
So you were reluctant to,
reluctantly heroic.
Yeah,
we were really just going in for the information, I guess.
Yeah,
we really were there just for the information. We just had to help them in order to get the information.
Yeah.
So Snooki, what was your thoughts on that? Like you kind of had to you went with the Whispers and that over the Vigil for some reason.
I believe the town was on a shore, like Jersey Shore.
Have we actually talked about the options?
This is why I didn't save it.
Have we actually talked about the options you were given? Like what they say, because what happens is you're summoned to your personal story instance.
I wouldn't save Jersey Shore.
And the three dudes are standing there and they're talking. Usually, I also recommend not walking up to them immediately and hitting F, because you'll stop their internal conversation.
Yeah,
because usually it's having an open world conversation
cool to
right
hear
there.
Them. Yeah,
and Logan Thackeray's there because he's a fucking retard. Yeah. And then,
but he doesn't talk, which is good.
And then,
but he talks in the same
eventually
manner,
you have to talk to him, and he gives you the outline of what the mission is, and then you're given the two choices. Like there's a surprising amount of choices, and then you talk to each one of the representatives of the groups. And they outline to you what their plan is, and then you make the choice and you go. So Snooki, what was the actual Whisperer's version of that plan? Was the plan to just tactical strike and just find one dude, or?
Sure, yeah, let's stick to that. I do not know. I do not. Wait,
it was basically like, I think you were trying to go after the dude, but he immediately escapes, and so it was more of just trying to get information.
So
on
you
him.
Were like a Stasi agent following an American journalist through East Germany.
I don't even know what to say to you.
What? Come on.
Oh, he's so innocent. Look at him. Look at him. Look at his face. But yeah, no, it's kind of indicative of the whole split between the orders, because the Vigil's idea for that one was that no man left behind. Right? We are not willing to sacrifice this village to find out information. We'd rather protect that village and then go through more effort to find out where the big bad guy is and take him out, rather than just like the Whispers, which is more like, hey, we can find the information quicker if we skip the village and just find where he is immediately and take him out immediately. That's the kind of difference between the two. It's interesting that they kind of loop both into the same event, though. Like, you both end up saving the village. I don't know how I feel about that. I don't know. It's odd that they do that. Anyway, but then what's next, Noob? That was a cool... Do you guys like that? How do you feel about the personal story stuff up to that point? Like, I found the centaur stuff a bit semi-engaging. I don't know.
It was okay.
The centaur stuff got kind of old.
Really? Yeah. I like killing centaurs.
I
feel like it kind of introduced you to the whole system.
They're a threat
to
humanity.
Mm. But
it really explains the situation
like,
humanity
like
30,
I guess. It really just starts picking up, and it goes a lot faster, and it's a lot more engaging.
Oh, it went to
it sets
30,
up like a background story for your race, basically. Like, what is the human race doing? Well, it's fighting off against centaurs. It has to deal with this internal politics.
I love how the humans are pieces of shit. Pretty good intro. There's just fucking...
Yep.
There's just internal backstabbing.
Like real-life humans.
There's like corrupt people and...
Yeah. So the next one was a pirate one. So basically, it turns out one of the Seraph people had been, you know, turned by Zaitan, and then he was going around trying to look for the queen, apparently, or something like that. You get the choice, a choice between a lesser of two evils. So so between the Whispers and the Priory. And of course, I couldn't give a shit about the Priory, so I took the
Whispers.
Which
one was this one? I don't remember this one. What was this?
The pirate one? You don't remember the pirate one?
The Whispers option was to infiltrate the pirates and get the information from them that way. The Priory option was to raise the ghost of fortune teller lady or whatever to find
fortune teller lady.
Oh, the pirates.
Yeah. I think it was. Yeah. No. It was.
She could tell the future.
It was the
one could have endangered the lives of innocent people.
Was that
one
the pirate?
Could just do it.
No. Yeah. It was the girlfriend of
the
dude
camp.
That you're gonna.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's not a girlfriend. It's not. It was just a fortune teller he met on a ship while working on the same ship.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. That worked.
So I did the Whispers one because it wouldn't cause any unnecessary damage.
Exactly. It's literally you go to this random middle of nowhere and you get the necromancer bitch summon this.
And then you talk to the guy, he gives you like pirate clothing. There's a great little thing where you have like a dissing match and you have to pick the right disses. Otherwise, like you they have to be like obvious pirates.
Wait. So which one did you pick? Did you pick the Whispers or
the Whispers?
Oh,
the
really? Okay, I disagree. I thought the Whispers was way worse than the Order.
Why?
See, Noob, did yours...
What do you mean, Whispers?
When you got the pirate costume, did yours break where you only saw it in the cutscene?
No.
Because mine, like, when I walked up to him, I was straight up wearing my clothes.
Yeah, you're right, it did. But it worked in the cutscene. I probably should have reported that, but whatever.
Because the pirate one could have gone sideways, and you could have ended up fucking killing everything. That's why I didn't do it.
No, I'm talking about if you raised a ghost and it ran away, what the fuck are you going to do?
The raising the ghost seemed unnecessary because you could get the information from the pirates without disturbing
her spirit. Exactly, so I did Whispers.
Oh, I did
that was the one where I actually didn't do Priory because of that.
For some reason, I don't know, I didn't think it through. I thought it would be safer for the necromancer to be there because necromancers aren't shit.
The necromancer who are evil.
But they're not evil. Necromancers are not terrible in this game. They're just serving
we're awesome.
I think
what about a ghost of a necromancer?
Necrophiliacs and pedophiles are okay.
But she wasn't. She just summoned this pirate bitch.
Matter of perception.
And the pirate bitch is like, haha, I tricked him. Ha, and then fuck off. That was it.
Yeah, clearly evil. Evil. Pure evil. Anyways, the Whispers involved like, and then you did like a dissing contest.
That was
like,
great.
Okay, your mother's a dick licking sea whore or whatever. It didn't say that. But it's something like that.
That's close.
That's a 72-hour ban for that NPC.
For the developer, banned from the offices. So you had to fend off against Waves of Risen, and then you're like, all right, we'll tell you the information. We can trust you.
Because
they trust you. They gave you the information you need, and then you're all, well, since you guys are landlocked, I'm looking to be a sailor, not a whatever the hell they were. So I guess this just won't work out, and then you walk away.
Exactly. You don't have to kill them. You don't have to do any unnecessary damage.
That sounds dumb.
You're a secret agent. You don't want to.
I still don't like the wielders.
Collateral damage.
They're jerks.
I prefer them over the Priory.
They are.
I prefer Whispers over Vigil.
I don't know.
Well, Dourin, really? You're scum. Dourin, you're scum.
Vigil's just Dourin's too. Shit. It's too like. It's too fucking military.
Hey, guess who wins wars?
Not the
soldiers.
Vigil.
Germany. Oh wait.
Soldiers.
No. Soldiers die in the war, and then everyone else wins it.
Do you see scholars winning wars? You see scholars out there fighting? Because I fucking sure as hell don't.
No, they sit back. At some point, they just stand on pillars.
Those are generals, and
they're
where generals
that
are.
The technology to make sure that you can win the war.
Yeah.
I think the point is that they have to work together to be successful. I don't know, guys.
No,
we're like, all right. You're the protagonist now. We're just the separate leaders of each organization, apparently. So the final mission involves a choice between all three of them, and you have to protect Queen Jenna from the crazy dude who was out for her blood.
I hated that one. Oh my god.
And then of course I picked Vigil because those were the ones like.
Well, what were the choices? I only read the Vigil one because that was the obvious one.
Yeah, because Vigil was actually fighting and defending.
So wait. Because you picked the Vigil one, I picked the Vigil one. Dourin, which one did you pick?
I don't remember what the choices were.
All of them.
And I would have to know what the choices were to know which one I picked.
Did you?
No, the one was where you're defending.
Okay, then I must have picked Vigil then because I remember doing the fight.
You're just standing there fighting them off.
Priory fights him too, but the Priory guys fight him with I think a wand or something.
Wait, no. Are you in the Priory?
Oh yeah. I totally picked Priory. That's right.
Yeah, exactly. Because that was the mission to pick where you joined.
Yeah, you get the item from the Priory and you try to fight them with that. It's a fucking pain in the ass.
Wait, what was it? Horrendous.
I want to go through the.
You basically get the item. You get the item that you supposedly used in the previous one or whatever with the Priory. I forgot what it was called.
Oh, the ghost invisibility thing.
Yeah, and so you're supposed to use that against them, and so you get a whole new fucking hotbar of abilities. And you have waves and waves and waves of guys coming at you. You have no idea what the abilities are.
It was ridiculous. I died 20 times. Not gonna lie.
Yeah.
Oh, see, if you were a man and you fought like you were supposed to with the Vigil, protecting the queen.
Yeah, so the choices were protect. They're all protecting the queen. I think the Whispers suggested taking the queen. Also, did anyone remember what the Whispers one was?
No.
Dress up as the queen, maybe? I don't know.
Fuck
knows.
I would have
picked that one, so I don't think that's right.
I wouldn't be surprised if that was actually Whispers, because that probably might have been.
It could have been. That would be pretty cool. It would be pretty cool, but.
That would be actually pretty cool.
Yeah, but they're assholes, so I didn't go near them.
What happens if.
So the Vigil one was straight up fuck it. We're just going to all stand next to.
We're going to actually protect the queen.
We're actually going to be there as bodyguards protecting the queen, and then the dude comes in and you just kill him, and that's it. It's really easy.
Yeah, that's it.
You just literally take out a wave of enemies and then kill the dude with your own skills, and you're done.
Yeah, that would have been really short.
Yeah, that would have been a bit easier than what
but then
ours was literally that same thing, but not with your own weapon.
Yeah,
right. But I'm sure you picked that because the choice is if you want to do any of these, you have to pick the selective or the what is it called missions.
Well, all these to this point is to inform you about the different approaches each order takes.
That was the before.
No. The one after that was the one where you picked.
Yeah.
Really?
It was after that mission.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I took the Vigil anyways. And
because once you save the queen, all the Vigil, all the orders want you, and then he's like, oh, well, all the orders want you, so make a choice.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
I don't want to be in an order of cowards or an order of Stasi, like Sookee.
So I want to hear this one and then move on because I want to hear what Benny's, so not Benny, wow, oh my god.
Yeah.
Zumi Raman's choice, experience of the Charr. But Logan Thackeray calls, after you save the queen, surprise, you save the queen. You are pulled into Logan Thackeray, the personal story instance again, and then they're all standing there, and Logan Thackeray goes, hey, you can pick between all three. And up to this point, I'd been, what was it? It was Priory once, then Vigil. And I didn't think, I totally expected myself to love the Priory because they're about defeating the dragon through knowledge, but they seem kind of shifty in some way. There seems to be knowledge first, saving people second. And the Whispers tend to be, knowledge as well for us, but more like a get like accruing like world knowledge, like just like background, like black knowledge, like stuff that you need to find out first, and then people second as well. So at this point, like they're all standing there, and you're asked to make a choice. And at least my experience was, I want to hear what your guys was as well, is the three are standing there, and up to this point, I thought in my head that I wanted to do the priory, but my heart was with the vigil. Like, weirdly enough, I was like standing there going, yep, looking at all of them, and then
you felt like they were your comrades.
Yeah, like you said, I fought with them
twice.
You could
trust them.
And we saved a bunch of people together, and the way they did it wasn't as dumb as the others. Like, honestly,
right,
it sounds stupid to say that just fucking let's just bodyguard the queen as your solution to the problem, but it was so effective. Like, straight up, it was incredibly effective way to do it, and she was safe the entire time. It's like the vigil is put in this position where everyone thinks they're dumb, but they're not. They're just militaristic. That they just,
like, it's not they're fighting with simply brute force. They still have tactics.
Yeah, really sound tactics. It's like an actual military. It's straight up a point where, like, especially later missions, they plan like huge tactical strikes across entire battlefields of people to overcome problems. Like that's the vigil's way. So I was standing there, and the three were there, and so the entire time I thought it was going to be with the priory, but I'd been leaning weirdly towards the vigil, and I didn't really understand at the time. So what you're given is a one last choice between them, and you have a couple of dialogue options to talk to the guy from each representative, and to inform you about their overall purpose. And so I believe what did you guys experience? Like, did you talk to them to actually figure it out, or had you already figured out where you're going by then?
I talked to them a little bit, and then I pretty much decided that priory sounded the most interesting, because like the vigil was just, like you said, pretty much like fighting dudes kind of, yeah, stuff, and fighting on the front lines and all that.
Mm-hmm.
The whispers one, like, it kind of sounded like it could be somewhat interesting, but like the priory one, like this idea of like exploring old tombs and finding out like hidden knowledge, and
yeah, because that's what he says, right? He's like, if you come with me to the priory, it'll be like a adventure of discovery. You'll be going to like weird new places and crypts and stuff. That's what he says when you talk to him, right? I think that's somewhat it.
Something
did
like
anyone
that, yeah,
talk to the whispers? Because I don't really remember too much about them.
All I remember is I checked all three of them, because I kind of had the same dilemma. I wanted to go with the priory, but I wasn't quite sure, like, because, mm-hmm, all seemed kind of interesting. So I checked out, there was an option to choose, and it showed you the, like, the titles you would get.
Oh, god damn
if
it.
You would,
If you
joined the order, and there's, mm-hmm, like, three, and you just, yep, kind of go up the rank in the order. So I did that, yeah, and, well, and then I just kind of...
What were they? Do you remember any of them? Do you remember any of them?
Yeah, sure. Let's see. The priory ones are initiate, scholar, and magister, I think.
Right.
Then,
I think the vigil one's like,
I know,
war
the
master?
Last...
What are you, Nuno?
Yeah, the last one...
I'm a war master.
Yeah, the last one for the vigil is war master, and the last one for the whisperers is lightbringer.
Yeah, that one's cool.
I don't
sounding,
remember,
right?
The other ones. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's pretty much the one that matters.
It goes from recruit, crusader to...
And then see, as an elementalist, like, why would you not choose priory and get magister?
Exactly.
I don't know, lightbringer sounds pretty cool.
It just makes
cool,
so much,
man,
sense.
Lightbringer sounds,
I'm cool, not a cowardly magician. I don't use
lightbringer,
magic to whisk
guardian
kids,
or maybe a warrior. But
well, lightbringer
as an elementalist,
is from the original game.
You just want to be a magister.
Yeah, like as an elementalist, you want to be magister. Like, that's yeah, badass.
So that's kind of interesting.
I'm definitely going with order on my feet.
You can pick them for like just pure story reasons or like role playing reasons, or you could pick them for what you think will be the most interesting, because you have enough information there to pick what you think is the most interesting in terms of the resultant missions. Because obviously, like, if you're interested in exploration and like crypts and stuff, then possibly the priory is for you. But the guy, the Order of Whispers guy, is like, you'll be doing like black ops. You'll be like sneaking into places. You'll be assuming personalities and personas and that kind of stuff to achieve your goals, which sounds actually cool. I would have found it fun to at least experience that. And it's kind of interesting to have to re-roll, but I guess that's part of the
Do
whole
you know-
choices thing.
It's thanks to the vigil that the Charr and humans are no longer fighting.
So the vigil one is straight up like, hey, we totally we're militaristic, but we enforce the peace. We make sure the factions don't
They're
war.
They're peacekeepers.
And we do a lot of charity work. And I was like, what? You do charity work? Yeah. And you talked to her about it. And she's like, yeah. Like, when in our downtime, we like totally feed the hungry. And it's like all this stuff the Vigil does. And I was like, holy crap. I didn't know.
They're like peacekeepers. How can you hate peacekeepers? Yeah, they might be in a, well, they're effective peacekeepers.
Yeah.
And we're so, not like, hating on them.
So, no, it's just like, I think the Vigil gets a bad rap. I gave them better. I underestimated
it's
them.
It's Priory and Whisper's propaganda.
Yeah. A lot of people have been going Whisper's and a propaganda. Lot of people going Priory. But I think that, at least for my character, well, the way I play video games is I'm the full Paragon Shepherd, if you know what I'm saying when I say that.
I usually play video games like I would well. Play.
Yeah.
Really? Like, I go for choices that I would make in real life.
I do too, and that's
morally cloudy.
Yeah, I
have a hard time being a dick.
Yeah, exactly. Even though the E people have feelings, man. E people have feelings. So
the problem with doing what I do is usually you never have enough points for either of the high end stocks, and you can't do anything.
Yeah. And then half your crew dies. But yeah, no, like, straight up, the Vigil is all about like charity and holding the priests at peace, and then overall, like tactically, they're like militaristic and large armies, that kind of stuff. Which is, I'm a warrior. I'm a human warrior named Human Warrior. That's where I'm at. I'm at the Vigil. And so that was cool. Like, which ones did you finally go for? Noob Mean went for Vigil. But what was your reasoning, Noob? Was it more of a that, or was it something else?
It was just, like, the Vigil were the coolest.
Cool. New Dourin?
Well, that and I just felt like that's probably the kind of combat I wanted to play.
I picked Priory for kind of a combination of, because I saw the title stuff too.
Yeah.
So it was kind of a combination of, like, I thought Magister was, like, the coolest fucking title for an elementalist.
Mm-hmm.
But also, just from, like, a gameplay standpoint, their missions sounded the most interesting, like, going into different, like, dungeons and crypts and finding these old ancient artifacts and, of course, all the dangers that come along with that.
Right. Sorry. Snooky?
Yeah, I went with the Priory too, and basically for the same reasons, I guess.
Cool. Well, I'm going to give. I think it'd be pretty cool if. Because I want to get to Zumi. I'm sorry, Zumi, but we've held off for you so long. But I want to get a little preview of what you can be expecting from each of these, just in case anyone out there wants to have information of which to choose. So the first mission of the Whispers, from what I've heard, is like this drunken bar fight kind of thing where you sneak into this place and there's a huge bar fight and you have to like. Well, at minimum, there's a drinking game involved. There's a huge drinking game involved, and everyone gets drunk, and you have to pour water on drunks to wake them up in the morning, and that kind of stuff. It's definitely fun. But what's the first mission of the Priory? Like, just like the basic synopsis.
The first mission has you going immediately into, like, you're supposed to be going back to the Priory, and instead, because the person who they have leading you is, she seems kind of, unstable, I guess. She's way too like for the adventure and not so much for safety.
Okay.
So she brings you as an initiate on to this like fucking dangerous tomb that like it was a dwarven
a
ruin that has never previously been explored. And so she brings you in there and you you basically discover some old dwarven relics and. Without going too far into the story, you kind of discover an ancient dwarven sword whose blade was made from dragon's blood.
Oh wow, that sounds cool.
Well,
that's pretty cool. So
you should give it to a Vigil.
The Vigil is pretty hilarious. wait, so Noob, was the Vigil the one with
hilarious.
the group of Charr or? Oh no!
Which one? There's a
lot of them. There's two back to back. I want to talk the second one instead of the first one. So the second one for the Vigil is you save the town from a huge onslaught of people. Like you're saving 100 people's lives, like tens and tens of people's lives by holding off this town by this onslaught by the Charr. But the second one is you now track those Charr down to their encampment. And you're with your war master, who's like your guide to introduce you to the Vigil.
Your partner.
It is the most hilarious thing because you're walking up to this like it's a nighttime mission and you're walking up to this encampment of sleeping Charr and you're talking to your war master and he's like you're like don't we need backup for this and he's like nah and then what are you talking about and he's like unorganized rabble and then he walks in and you're sneaking up to them and they're lying down they're all asleep right and you walk up to them and he just you think you're going to slit their throats tonight. Like, that's what I thought we were going to do. I thought we were going to be brutal and efficient, and I was surprised. But what happens instead is, as we're walking up to them, he goes, "Wake up, you stupid Charr!" Like, the equivalent of, like, he just, like, wakes up the entire yeah. camp so they have a chance to fight against you.
See, I didn't see that part because I just rushed in and started hitting things while they were sleeping. And what the funny thing is, I hit them with my throw, like my launching one, so the one that knocks yep. back, and they stayed in that same sleeping position, and I threw them. It would look hilarious.
Yeah, so, like, and then on top of that, like, for me, I woke up slowly, and then he wakes up all the Charr, to give them a fighting chance, and he starts, like, he walks up to the tenses and just starts fucking setting them on fire with the Charr still inside, and then, the tent falls down, there's, like, Charr walking out, and they have the burning condition on them, and they're like, oh god, and then he just fucking slaughtered them, and the entire thing, just slaughtering a camp of Charr with just you and your Warmaster. It's so hilarious and cool. It was awesome. But yeah, so that's a preview of the three. I want to move on to Zumi Ramen. How was your first experience with your personal story? What legion did you choose as the Charr?
Which what
legion? Do you remember? Did it matter to you what legion you chose? Are you...
I can't remember.
Are you serious?
to be honest, not really. Like, it hasn't grabbed me yet.
Okay.
I mean,
have you done any of the personal story?
You said it gets going about level 30.
Oh yeah,
I haven't made any of the choices.
The Charr personal story stuff starts out pretty interesting, though.
I'm sure.
Like, the first thing you do is, like, fucking overthrow the leader of your legion, and you, like,
yeah. I think you become the new leader. Basically, a lot of time I was doing that. I was in Mumble, so I was kind of distracted, but. I got the general.
Yeah, basically, what happens with the Charr stuff?
Yeah,
early on,
you overthrow it. And
well, like before that though, like he's just a fucking dick to you the whole time. Like, you are just worthless trash. You can't do anything right. And he's just riding on you constantly, and then just, like, kind of out of nowhere, you're like, you know what? Fuck you.
Well, I don't mind the riding on me.
You basically fuck you. Get in the ring. I'm challenging you to take over this warband.
Oh wow, really?
Yeah,
and
you do that.
Yeah, that's cool. One of the first things you do, like level fucking like 6 or something, you are challenging your warband leader to a fight in the arena, and fucking then your first choice is, do you kill him or do you let him go?
Oh wow.
I'll let Dourin tell you about my personal story.
Well, I experienced some of it as well. That sounds interesting. How much did you
get? Yeah, like I was saying, because you were saying, you know, you didn't have many choices, but I was like, oh yeah, I remember that one where you could kill him or like just send him packing.
So, Zumi, did you kill him or did you let him go?
No, I let him go because I like people to live with the shame. I think it's.
Oh, fuck that. I killed his ass.
Wow, really? That's crazy.
Well,
he was such a dick. You know what? He died.
I mean, I killed his ass, but that was me.
Do you remember your second choice?
Yeah, I let him go. And the second choice was like something to do with your dad. Then it all gets about your dad.
Well, no. Before that, your second choice was, it was immediately after, you choose who you want to for the last spot in your warband. So you choose between the necromancer and the...
Oh, yeah, I chose the necromancer.
Okay, I think that one was like a thief or something?
Yeah, necromancer or a thief.
So what was your reasoning for choosing the necromancer on that one?
I wanted another necromancer.
See, you serious?
My reasoning on that one for choosing a necromancer was I kind of had this feeling like whoever you didn't choose was going to end up on a competing warband and you were going to have to fight them later.
Okay.
And I did not want to fucking fight a necromancer.
Nice.
So I just chose a necromancer on my side.
Good thinking.
I was like, if anyone starts questioning my dark arts, I'll have this necromancer that I picked up to back me up. So that's why I picked him. But yeah, I picked the necromancer. And then I do remember it, actually. Yeah, then you start getting into your stuff about, like, you do a few warband missions where you're sorting stuff out, but then the next big storyline is with your dad.
Oh, right, yeah, because it depends, because you chose the, your dad was a Flame Legion shaman or some shit, right?
I think I chose that he was a bit of a scumbag.
Yeah, same thing.
So it turns out, like, he's protecting his, like, sparring partner or best friend or something,
right,
by giving the Flame Legion an artifact that will, like, give them the world, I don't know, give them the world or some shit.
So So to be more general about it, there's a couple things about the story missions which I find interesting. Like the first one is that at least after level 30, and again, yeah, Zumi, you probably once you hit level 30, you'll feel it start picking up.
Yeah, thanks,
up.
Thanks, thanks a lot, guys.
Yeah, sorry, but yeah, so like which is like starts getting really interesting around the world. But I guess hopefully there are a bunch of choices like the ones in the human and all, across all of them. Like we haven't got a Silvara here, and we haven't got a Zumi. No, they don't count.
Literally didn't get shit about the story for Silvara. Something about plants. I don't know.
Oh, God.
That's great.
Wow.
That's
great.
So
I will say, though, like as somebody who didn't really have any interest whatsoever in Charr, I actually only even really made one because I was going to make a warrior, and I asked everyone to mumble, like, should it be Norn or should it be Charr? And everybody insisted Charr, so I decided to make it. And I'm kind of glad I did because actually, like, the story of the Charr, early on at least, is seeming a lot more interesting than I kind of gave them credit for being able to do with that race.
Right. Yeah, it's just...
like.
Dude, yeah. The person's story is just well done. I'm surprised to say this.
Yeah.
And I don't have anywhere near as many issues with the cutscenes as I used to. Like, how do you guys feel about it now? I think they pretty much feel okay. They're not terrible.
Like, what were the issues
they're
you had?
A bit...
So before...
I thought they looked kind of ugly.
Yeah, they were ugly. And while they were under construction, like, they weren't looking at each other during the cutscenes. Like, there was no eye contact. There didn't seem to be much in the way of gesticulation. And it just didn't sound like two people talking together. But now, like, I don't have any problems with that anymore. They're looking at each other. They're reacting to each other.
Yeah.
Like, any thoughts?
And I still, it's like, they feel a bit weird.
Yeah.
Like, I'll just run up to them and then it'll go into this cutscene of them two just, right. like, standing
but
by
each
other.
But the thing is, like, it's the best way to see their faces and, like, their front of body without having being like, hey, we're looking all at you guys.
Yeah. And
yeah, like, it's not bad enough that I'm like, oh, this is shit. It's just sort of like, it's a bit... It's a tiny bit weird, but right. I'm like, this is kind of cool.
Yeah.
This is all right.
Yeah, it's in some of the art, like especially the towards later story missions, some of the art you start seeing in the background starts looking absolutely amazing. It's visually interesting. It's different. It's different and not terrible. I guess that's my main part of the cutscenes. But the story itself...
Oh, shout.
The story itself, I'm surprised at how good it can get
Fine.
In some spots.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Man.
Yeah,
I was surprisingly pulled by the characters. Yeah. Like,
are you going to say something about that? What was your example of that, Noob?
This is a bit late on. Can I spoil
what level is it? Just set it out front so people can tell whether or not to listen.
You know the Claw Island thing?
No, I haven't been there. But just tell them what level it is so people listening can have an idea of what you'll be spoiling.
About 50.
When's the Claw? No, it's not 50.
It's 46, isn't
it? It's about 40, 46, around there. Yes. Yeah. So if just like tune out for like what
a minute, one minute.
Right,
one,
I will take my headset
so
off
basically,
for a minute. Then
are you okay with this?
I'm fine. I've had enough people talking about this specific mission to go on.
When that dude dies, so the War Master that was with you the entire time dies.
Okay.
And then you know how it's like I'll hold them back. You know the typical like cheesy stuff like that. Like I'll hold them back. You go on without me, and then the dude perishes fighting off those dudes. Mm-hmm. I always thought those were cheesy until that dude died, and I was fucking sad.
Man, that's...
I never felt that sad in a video game.
I didn't know he was going to die, but I totally am feeling it now. That's cool. I can't wait for that.
Like, and the way they presented, it's just not a terrible, cheesy kind of thing.
Does it get a Boromir...
Really present it well.
From 0 to Boromir, Boromir being 10.
It's way better than... Like, it's 10 being Boromir.
Dude, 10 Boromir was amazing. Fuck you.
8 or 9. 8 or 9.
Cool.
It was like it might have been just me, but it's just like due to like the kind of character he was, and you started to like, hey, he's a pretty cool guy, and then when he dies,
he is a really cool guy, like, because you start off again, he seems like this big butch like dude or whatever,
and the conversation you two have, it's not like I'm gonna go die, it's like no, don't leave me. It's actually pretty well done. It is.
I can't
really
wait.
Well done.
I can't wait to see that. I didn't want to know he died, but I'm
very,
happy I know that
it's
now.
It's very sad. It's very sad.
Interesting.
But. Yeah,
the stuff that you actually get attached to something.
Well, really pick up though.
So, Sookee, did you feel like you got attached to any of your like main like the people you're with in the Dourin Priory?
Yes, I really like the main chick. I guess that is kind of your magister. And
I just want to know this just quickly. Does she die too? I know this.
Yes, she does.
I believe
she
will die.
She, I,
That's kind of sad.
That's a pattern, I think.
I don't know how I feel about that.
It is sad. Yeah.
That's all I want to know about it, because I haven't gotten that far yet.
Yeah, so. I don't think
I don't want to know the details of it.
Yeah, I don't.
Yeah, no.
I was so surprised.
Just one thing, and it's no spoilers. I felt it was just a little bit rushed. I thought it came just really quickly. The relationship between you and your magister. It could have gone like two more missions, I guess, before she, you know, died.
I think just the way that I've interacted with my dude, because we definitely need to move on. But the way I interacted with my dude, I kind of immediately started liking after the first bit. Like as soon as he started like waking up the Charr and saying that shit on fire, I was like, this guy's cool. I'm with this guy.
Like just conversing with the dude hearing his quips, it was just great.
I agree.
And then losing him was a big.
I liked moment. I liked my magister right off the bat, but I felt like it was too easy. Too early for her to die.
Right.
It should have taken longer to build up a relationship.
So, anyone accidentally tuning in then? Sorry. But anyway. So, with that, I guess we can move on to the reason I wasn't fucking... Because I'm level 54. What level is everyone? I'm level 54.
62.
I don't know. 62, I think.
You're the same level as me.
40 something.
Mid-40s.
So, Dourin, in your case, you just haven't been crazy like the rest of us and not spending all your days playing Ghost 2, right?
Well, I have a kid, so during the day, I can't really play, so I don't start really playing until the evenings.
Yeah, and I've been playing 11 to... Fuck you, Dourin Ramen.
Yeah, the biggest bummers are like when you have to actually do real-life stuff and you can't play Guild Wars.
Yeah, like I'm starting work on Monday.
I've had that about like...
Like the kid I've got is just so.
God damn it, Zumi!
He keeps shouting.
I've had kids in my basement.
I keep telling him to
shut
up, or else
I'll just kill him. You kill him.
You got to tell him you're never gonna let him leave, and then he shuts the fuck up.
Well, I've got him farming gold so I can get gems and stuff.
Oh, that's child labor.
Okay,
that's illegal.
Sweet.
Oh wow!
Yeah, but
I found Jolly Ranchers work really well as an incentive.
How did that happen?
You just tell them you won't beat them, and they will.
Wait, you say they don't have those in Australia?
I don't have them in Australia. I don't have Jolly Ranchers.
They don't have them in England.
All right, I've never lived in Australia then.
What is Jolly Ranchers?
They don't have them in England.
I don't like Jolly Ranchers.
Have you never heard the Jolly Ranchers story?
Hard candy.
Yeah, you bet they're hard candy.
I don't know. They're Jolly Ranchers. Like, there's no way to describe them because they are just them.
Have you heard the Jolly Ranchers?
Anyway, we're almost at the 3-hour mark. Oh, it might be. Close to the 2-hour mark.
Yeah, we're almost at the Zumi Ramen's about.
Yeah,
to
so Zumi Ramen, we're going to be talking about dungeons from here on out. Do you have to tap out?
Sure, because I haven't done a dungeon.
Yeah, cool. So that's cheers.
I won't be. Any
it's just anyway. Like the typical dungeons you see from Sookee
like
Homeland
Dead
videos.
Is
it's like what Mines? You see from what Sookee would be watching on television at this time.
What? Oh yeah, give me that.
It's 6 a.m. in the morning. I don't
twist
my
nipples. Yeah, 6 a.m. That's perfect. That's
the
when
final
you yank
tactic
it.
To beat this boss is twisting my nipples.
So yeah, see you, Zumi Ramen. You just need to be cool.
Yeah.
The reason I've been mainly not doing personal story stuff is that I've been fucking doing dungeons, like just straight up.
Yeah, you've been fucking them.
I'm level 54, and I've only done up to level 36 in my personal story stuff, so that's why I didn't know about that thing. But, dungeons in this game. Jesus Christ. So, who's done what? Dourin, what dungeons have you done so far?
I've done Ascalon Catacombs story and One Path of Explorable, and then I've done story of Catacus's Manor, or Mansion, whatever.
New Burma?
I've done exactly the same as Dourin.
Nice. You did Codicus Madman as well?
Yep. I'm planning on doing
you haven't done Explorable, you've just done the story.
No. Okay, cool. Yep.
And Snooki, you've done a shitload, right? What have you done?
I've done two... Wait, I did Ascalon Catacombs story mode.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I did two paths expo mode.
Yep.
I did Codicus's Manor story and one expo mode.
Yep.
And I did Auber,
Story mode.
Story mode.
So I've done all three paths of Ascalon Catacombs Explorable mode, Codicus Manor, and the story mode, obviously. Codicus Manor story mode only, and Twilight Arbor story mode only. So if people listening don't want to hear anything about those, then tune out now. This is going to be the rest of the show, I think, because at least a half an hour, probably. And then we're going to end the show out. So, all right, well, let's start with Ascalon Catacombs. Thoughts?
Oh, man.
Okay, so there are these catacombs in Ascalon, and they're called the Ascalon Catacombs. Really?
Actually, they're called the Ascalonian Catacombs.
Oh, Sookee. Yeah. Done.
They're called the Ascalonian Catacombs.
I would drop my mic, but it's kind of attached. So.
Yep.
That was just lag where you didn't hear the I was about to say it. And there are these things you have to fight.
So the kind of the entire point of the dungeons fights. Is that they have their own stories, like at the start of them, and it seems to all to be about Destiny's Edge, right? I think that's the...
Yep, it's basically bringing Destiny's Edge together. I don't know how the fuck they got together to do these dungeons, because they were all fucking disagreeing at my level, like, 60 quest in some sort of ghostly kind of thing. And, you went to Ore 2?
I haven't been to Ore.
Okay, that thing's funny. Or, that's actually kind of scary when they were talking. But,
the first
right. Ascalon, so it's basically
catacombs. Yeah. What's it about? I think it's air, because I didn't read it too deeply, because at that point I didn't really care. But
it's basically, so these guys are in Ascalon catacombs getting, or whatever they were getting, because I wasn't really paying attention. Yep. But air has gone by herself and fucked everything up because she's not human, and she
found
that
for everyone. The brother sword to Sohothin, I think it was.
That's the flaming
thing. Something like that. The sword that, what's his face?
And it's like, I'm going to go on ahead and fuck it up for everyone. So every player in this world has to do this dungeon over and over and over again.
Air goes to this dungeon to get the sword, to give it to Logan Thackeray, to reunite Logan and Britlock to get Justice's Edge back together. That's kind of the overarching thing.
And she goes off on her own with her stupid fucking wolf. Unfortunately, they don't die. I wish they had. But so you go on Ridlock's complaining, like, oh, this bitch. And then you follow complaining Ridlock across the fucking... I think we talked about Ascalon Catacombs when I did it in the beta weekend thing. But basically a recap is you go through... All of the monsters are veteran, unless it's rare to find non-veteran monsters or non-bosses. Yeah. So there's a beginning zone where you... constantly fight a bunch of veterans, maybe spiders pop up, and then you fight a boss. You go through the next zone, there are a fucking shitload of traps, and then it's just pulling groups of three at a time. There are a couple of puzzles, like putting a boulder on top of a platform to open a door. And then basically that, you find...
And there's the three major bosses,
Three
major bosses.
Right. You get reunited with this dumb bitch. For the people who played Guild Wars 1, you find King Adelburn, who was the king of Ascalon before the Faux Fire and everything happened. And basically, he says, what the fuck are you doing in my tomb? So a captain appears, then you fucking fight the captain, and then you get this chest. You open the chest, it's shit drops, because the arena fucking hates you. And then you do the shit drop, you get the shit drops. You go into the main boss section. So there's basically three sets of bosses. Yep. So you have Aiden, who was a trainer. Who's a ranger trainer.
Master Nente.
Master Nente was a trainer. They're all giant people for some fucking reason. they're giant people. So his fight is literally he's on his own platform, and everyone should be going around in like a different island of a platform, and everyone's firing at him.
Yeah, like, these are all pretty tactical.
I'll do a general run-through first, I guess. And then he sometimes teleports, fucks you up, whatever. Kill him, get another useless chest, waste inventory space. There's another boss who... This is one... Okay, I'll skip the Mesmer one for last. Yeah, Mesmer one last. The next one was... What the fuck was the
next Necromancer. One? Remember.
The Necromancer. So the Necromancer is probably the easiest one. It's literally one Necromancer. Sometimes spawns spiders, but really it's a big joke. I don't know why they put it in. Fuck your internet. I hate wasting my time. And then the third one, which was...
The best. Really good boss fight.
Like the
really
best, fight. But best, fuck you, because it's a waste of time. It's basically... these are two lovers. They are all encased in one tomb. Or two different tombs, and then when they rise up together, basically the big trick is if they're together, like near each other, they're really powerful. Yeah. So the point of the dungeon was to split them up away from each other, because they're lovers and love conquers all or whatever the fuck, but clearly it doesn't, because you kill them, and then you get a chest, and then you fight King Adelburn at the very end, and then you get a fucking stupid hat. the end.
Sums
and then now you can do this dungeon 100 different times.
That is actually surprisingly accurate, the whole thing. So the first fight, so when you kill one of these bosses, you generally spawn a waypoint. That was us to start getting to the tactics of the dungeon. So the entire mission is for level 35s, but I don't. What would you say, Sookee?
Well, the story is 30.
Oh, right. 30. Yeah, story is 30. Okay, we'll just. I don't think we're going to talk about the explore mode tactics because I don't want to.
We can just talk about the explore in general.
Yeah, our experience.
So we'll start with story mode. So level 30s, would you do it at level 30? I did at level 30. I didn't have
a problem. Yeah, I did at level 30 during the beta weekends, and they haven't changed really.
It doesn't seem like it's too difficult.
No, I guess doing it at 30 is totally fine. I actually recommend if you're like super eager to do it and cannot wait, I guess like from 27 up.
No, I would not say Ascalon Catacombs.
No, 27, yeah.
Unless you've already
if you're an organized people.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Then I guess it's
difference
okay.
You have to have experience with it if you're going to run at 27.
Yeah, I guess so. But it is very difficult. Even
compared, like, as a first dungeon,
if all your experience with Guild Wars 2 is PvP and, like, normal PvE in World Wars of the World, this is going to be a shock to you, because it is legitimately difficult the first time through.
They're jizzing on your face.
What?
Yeah, and I guess for people that are not used to that kind of combat or that kind of dungeon, like, system...
Better have gotten the... Or if you don't know how to dodge properly yet, you're going to learn it in this dungeon.
This is going to be a educational experience for a lot of people if it's their first time through a dungeon. Right. Dourin, what's your thoughts on, like, the difficulty of... What level did you do that? What are your thoughts on the difficulty of Ascalon Catacombs Story?
I did it at 30. We had a few guys in that were in their 40s. And then one guy that was, no, I think 30 was the lowest we
had. Retiring.
Yeah.
But overall, difficulty wise, like it was kind of one of those where like, it was kind of maybe difficult at first until you understood what you were supposed to do. And then it was just easy.
Yeah.
As long as you weren't Matt Kessler, because he's made out of paper, apparently, and just fucking dies when something looks at him.
Well, he's like, did you guys find any leather? Was he saying that? Give me free leather? Because I bet he was.
But otherwise, it wasn't terribly difficult. Like, we did go down a few times, but I don't think we ever wiped through the entire place.
Okay.
So, difficulty-wise, it wasn't too bad. But I will say, I'll agree with you guys, like, if it's your first time through, you've only done like PvE and maybe structured or something, or even world versus world, the difficulty of this, and more so like just how hard hits really hit you for, is definitely going to be a bit of a shock.
Because you're daggers at least.
So you're gonna realize that you very quickly need to get the fuck out of the way and start looking for tells on attacks and making sure you dodge at proper times.
Absolutely. How many hits could you take as a daggers at least, for example?
From a regular veteran unit,
like two or three,
and then you're just done.
And then I was just down. But generally, like especially with the build that I have, if I'm getting hit two or three times and going down, it's probably my fault because I have like two bubbles I can pop to make sure that I don't take damage.
Right.
So,
and it's interesting.
It's not too bad.
A lot of these just okay. So getting into the tactics of it, because I guess we can. Just like say that, you should know what you're doing.
Yeah.
Just before I move to tactics, one last thing: do you guys think you could do this with a story mode with an organized rabble?
A pug. Probably
story mode.
As long as everyone knows what they're doing or have done it before, like
right.
That said, when me and Sookee and a bunch of other dudes run it, and we were like a pretty experienced group. Like, even having done Ascalon Catacombs a couple months back, we wiped at least once. Especially at that stupid bitch-ass fucking...
Right, that's like a lover's couple.
The mesmer thing.
Yeah.
Oh, that's just because you're bad at me.
It got to the point where they reset in their respective spots, and they did an aggro.
Yeah, we kind of bucked it out the first time.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
that's good times. Okay, so... Sookee, what was your experience with the dungeon your first time? When did you do it your first time? Because I'm not sure. I didn't run with you.
I have no idea. It feels
How
like,
old were you when you did it?
It feels like I did it like on the first day.
I know.
Or maybe the second.
I know.
It's been a long time.
Like a virgin for the first time.
The general idea is the dungeons are difficult, yes, but the bosses all have like a pattern to them. And again, if you don't want this ruined for you, I'd say to probably tune out for the rest of the episode, I'd say. But
yep, let's so get out. Just get out of my house.
So the bosses you're looking at, the first one is when you kill the boss, you spawn a waypoint. And so Khalil, or the Kallax, or Murderbo, however you refer to him, told me that the best way, and I kind of agree with him, the best way to wipe them out is to go start with Nentei, then hit the Necromancer, and then hit the Lovers. Not only does that keep your group morale up, because you won't wipe for that until maybe the end, but also you spawn a waypoint to the left, and then a waypoint to the top right, and the Lovers don't spawn a waypoint. So you have two easy waypoints to get back to the Lovers, when you probably wipe your first time through. So
did you guys really have that hard of a time with the Lovers?
Depends on what comp I was running and what group of people I was running. I've done Ascalon Catacombs normal version maybe about 4 times now. So, in 2 of them we had wipes, in 2 of them I didn't have wipes. So, depends. Hmm. It depends. What would you say about Nentei Sookee?
Was it the Mesmer?
That Nentei is the Ranger.
The Ranger.
Run them through it.
Okay, so the Ranger stands on a pillar, like in the center of the room, and he I think he's what does he do? Like he does an AOE.
Yeah, he does AOE.
He has like
he fucking teleports to your side.
He stands on his pillar and he just targets random ranged guys and
melee
guys too.
He's like the biggest fucking joke.
And
I went on his pillar and meleeed him.
Yeah, he throws AOE randomly. And
he doesn't do shit if you do
twice
that.
Twice during the fight, he just teleports to the ranger camp or one of the rangers.
He's like in the middle, and there's like a semicircular kind of ledge around the outside. And so you can have your
And then he spawns 2 wolves.
You can have your ranged deeps staying on the ledge the entire time, and your melee is running up a little like a wooden plank that leads up to that center platform. That's how Noob and
fucking hard to
Dourin
see.
Were able to deep some melee.
Yeah, that's how you should do it.
Yeah, and so halfway through, like 2 points during the fight, he teleports to the circular the semicircular platform, and starts like taking your back line. But he isn't the problem, right?
The wolves are.
So, because every time he teleports he summons a wolf. And the wolves do a shitload of damage, way more than he does.
Well, I didn't take any damage because I just stood in the pillar dancing.
that's a theme. Yeah. He just keeps doing that.
Yeah. And so
we did that in
the floor. That's pretty much it. Like, you deeps him, then he teleports over. You have to focus down the wolves first. I very much recommend that. Then he deeps him some more. He goes back to the center. You deeps him again from range. He teleports back to you. You take out the second wolf.
Like, he's not that big of a problem.
It's pretty easy.
Well, that's because he didn't even ever try to hit me because I never took his aggro.
Yeah, he's pretty easy. You can potentially wipe if you don't take out the wolf first. I've never wiped it, but I can see how it could happen. But
yeah, definitely. Yeah. Those wolves are, if you're not paying attention to your allies' health, especially in like a pug where you're not on voice.
Yeah,
Those wolves might be dangerous.
Like, if you don't have fingers and you can't press your buttons to hit your 6th heal or something.
Then you might wipe.
Well, no, because you're busy fighting is the problem.
Oh, well, yeah.
I guess.
Or dancing.
That it's like having a room full of mute children and then a wolf comes in. Like, what are those kids going to do?
Oh, my God.
Well, I know exactly what happens, but I will not go into that sort of graphic.
So I do that fight first, and then you move over to the right-hand side, and I would say do the Necromancer second. So... The Necromancer, yes. Dourin, do you want to run me through the Necromancer?
No, because I don't remember much of that fight.
That's a good point.
Everyone running in, hitting it for a couple of minutes, and what a fucking waste.
You basically run in. He casts like fire around the room, so you have to stand like in the middle of the room, and then she just
he is, by the way, so it doesn't really matter.
So then she just casts AOE damage. It's like 3 area circles, just kind of combined to make a bigger area. And you just have to dodge out of that and circle strafe around her and just down her.
I'm a boss. I'm so powerful.
And I guess like at one point, maybe she just like summons 4 adds and she just kind of channels.
You don't even need to pay attention to
them. Onto the adds, but
they just
nobody
died
really
to
knows
everyone's AOE.
I don't think I even realized that was a boss fight.
Yeah, it's ridiculously easy.
Like, there were enemies in there that were harder than that encounter.
Yeah. Oh, dude. Yeah. So along the way between
I guess
these,
we can just skip this one.
You're fighting these Ascalon ghosts, and those come in like different groups.
Oh, and there's like random events. We forgot to mention those. The dynamic
Which ones
events
are they?
In the dungeon.
Yeah,
they're not actually dynamic
events in the dungeon. Is like the coolest fucking thing.
Except like once you go straight for the mounds, it's very simple.
Wait.
Why did you mean the concept?
Yeah, the concept. The Ascalon Catacombs story. I don't remember it.
I didn't even count that as an event.
It's not dynamic.
It was really just
yeah. It's
what
just
is it?
Like
I felt like well the mount can't spawn and like run and attack you, so we'll just make it an event, so you know you have to attack it.
Wait, what are you guys talking about? Which one is this?
You know when the wall suddenly breaks and then it's and like kill the scales or whatever
the mound pops up and they start spawning out.
Yeah. Oh, what are they called? Gravelings. So the gravelings are these things are a theme for the Ascalon Catacombs dungeon. And they spawn out of these mounds that come out of the ground, and then they just fucking like
you will have some sort of hate for them by the end of this game. I guarantee
you will despise them.
Because
yeah, so that's like they kind of want to introduce you to the concept of them because they appear a lot in the explorer mode version of the dungeon. So that they come.
Do this, they ever?
This mound raises out of the ground, and then they just infinitely spawn out of the mound until you take the mound out. That's generally the idea.
I feel bad for the people who don't notice that you got to kill the mound first, and they just fed endless waves.
Yep. It's kind of sad. So those are one enemy group, and those aren't too bad in Ascalon Catacombs. Normal. I don't think any group has ever had a problem with those. But the ghosts along the way are probably harder.
They are all veterans, and they're groups of three.
Yeah, the groups of three. It's like two rangers and a warrior.
If you are not careful, the biggest problem you can make in those areas is aggroing more than one group. Yeah. Dealing with six veterans, like even if you're in a good group, it's
you
quite
chaotic.
You
don't want to be doing that.
And yeah. You can survive if you just really nail it, but like you do not want to take that chance.
But like you just want, like it's not too time consuming. You just find one group, kill them, and then move on to the next. It just be very careful when just running around in that area.
So the general consensus is, I'd say.
Oh, we didn't talk about
focus the down thing the yet. Like the when you meet one of those groups first. Yeah, I want to talk about the mesmerist last. So when you meet one of those, second last. When you meet one of those groups, I'd say the general consensus is focus down the monk first. Like if you see a monk, because
it's the relic of the Holy Trinity.
I forgot like the really most important thing at the start of Ascalon Catacombs. There's a room full of fucking coffins. Don't open more than one at once. Just open one at a time.
And the traps. Just pull on all the chains you can find.
Yeah. To be honest, I'd designate a group leader because just one for doing stuff like that, calling out targets, etc.
Yeah,
it makes your game a lot.
Yeah, because like you open up and a lot of groups just go in and open all the casks and then wipe. And then you're screwed because the ghosts will just wait there and you're fucked. Like that's it. If you go in, open one,
they will literally take you and fuck you. That's
pretty
exactly
much. And
what
the boss
will
do it even harder. Like because the point is like if you open one of them, like you're opening them all so you can spawn a boss. And I think there's some level of randomness to it. I'm not sure if he always opens in the same one. So essentially, you end up slowly working your way around the room, taking out one veteran at a time, then spawn the boss and take him out. And that's the start of the dungeon. That's like the very start of Ascalon Catacombs. Just make sure you do it once. And also encourage your group to not loot until the end, because if they're wandering around hitting F, they can accidentally open a fucking tome.
Oh, God.
And shit gets
that might have happened.
May have happened once or twice.
It's all right. I was a group leader. I was supposed to do
so
that.
So those are the main problems with just walking around. And everything's relatively easy. Everything's manageable to this point.
Just do stuff with care, I guess.
Take it slow.
Just pay attention.
Watch the ground for traps. Like,
Traps.
Pull the chains for the traps. Everywhere disable the traps. Like you absolutely have to pull the chains.
And like when the dragon suddenly spawns, just
run
away.
So that doesn't matter. Anyway, so... the last main boss fight before Adelburn is the Mesmers. So how did you guys approach which group did you run with, and what was their strategy for the Mesmers?
Basically, in the beta weekend, I had a different strategy, and it actually worked out better for some reason. But during our main thing was we just tried to use crowd control to separate them.
Okay.
And these were the only bosses that had proper, like, they could take a lot of crowd control damage. But it just... those mesmers, they had some sort of whirling thing that would like reflect any sort of movement getting near them, too. Especially since our party was pretty heavy melee, weren't we, Sookee?
Yeah, I think it was me informing.
It's like we were just trying to get close to hitting him, and then we just get knocked back, and they'll just get closer.
Yeah, it's like these sealed
up. Got to the point where we'd knock them over. Yeah, we'd knock them over, and then they just immediately run back to each other. And I'm like, oh,
because they have both have. So like, we just there's a mesmer and elementalist. It was a constant. The female's an elementalist, and the male's a mesmer. There's a couple things you have to work out for, because if they get close to one another, once one is within the other's circle, well, circles overlap. There's like two. Okay, I'll run it through. So when they're in each other's circles, I believe the male will have like an invincibility field around him, and he can't touch him. When the female enters the invincibility field, she starts healing back to max health. So you have two chances, really. Like when they're in the bigger circles of each, the male becomes really hard to kill, and they're really close together, they both become impossible to kill. So the entire point is to try to separate them out. So the problem with that is a lot of the CC or rate, like the knockbacks in this game, are melee range. Fear barely ever works on them because they have those like modifiers for being a boss, like very low percentage chances of CC working. I'm not going to use the word CC anymore. I hate that word. So control, like so even range control, is difficult. Mm-hmm. So the main way we found of doing the boss fight really easily, because you do want to keep them separated, is to just use the boulders. Like, Sookee, were you there when I did the two people in boulders duty run?
Use the boulders. Just always use boulders. Always. Even in the open world, just always use them.
So there's these boulders around, which you generally use to put on pressure plates to open doors and stuff during the dungeon. But if you throw it, like the one skill when you have a boulder in your hands is just throw it. And if you hit one of the lovers with the boulder, it not only interrupts them, but it usually, if they're in the right spot, knocks them back a significant distance. So you can do the entire party, like that, the entire mission with just two people on boulder duty, each focusing on the opposite one, picking up boulders, throwing at them, interrupting their attacks, and knocking them away from one another, while the other guys just do deeps. And that's the easiest way. That's the easiest way I've seen to do it, because they're invalidated. Most of this shit is invalidated. The only thing...
Or you could do what we did and just have die so many times they reset, but they reset by themselves and we kill them one by one.
There you go.
That works too.
Yeah, it works too. Also, I would say...
Go on. Just one thing I'd like to mention. I think the Mesmer, he keeps spawning little magic something adds, and they deal a shitload of damage. Dude, so
shitload. So the Mesmer spawns
there
adds.
Should be someone on add duty.
Yeah.
He also can be kind of a dick and just randomly teleport directly on top of her.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man.
Right on top, man. Not when there's people. Just do it in the bedroom.
Fucking mounts right up. Yeah, it's... No, our group did kind of a combination of, like, noob strategy and the boulder strategy. Yeah. We had basically me and Matt both on boulder strategy.
Yep.
And the reason why I stuck on it as well is because I also have a knockdown, knockback ability.
Yeah. Yeah, I was with the other time, yeah.
So in an emergency, we were able to just get rid of him as well.
So what happened to us was we went in and we wiped twice. And then we were like, how about we just fucking use these boulders? And we just won. It was easy.
For my first run, I basically just split into two groups with one there to deal with the mobs and the other two, each group focusing on one. And it seemed to work. I don't know why I didn't do that the second time around.
Nice. Yeah, so... That's pretty it. Like, you have to be on bumpsy. Oh yeah, the mesmer does area confusion, so really watch out for that.
Oh god,
I kept bumming myself.
Yeah,
just turn on invulnerability via console, and you'll be okay. Oh wait, am I not allowed to?
So, bring condition removal. Shit. Watch for confusion. It's just a little purple like speech box looking thing around you when you use a skill. It does damage to you every time you use a skill, and it does a lot of consistent damage, and he gets many stacks up on you, and you can die real fast by killing yourself using that. Confusion. That's it. Like once that's done, you then fight Adelburn, and he's pretty easy. Like there's no real thoughts, guys?
Like he does damage, but it's just like a simple boss fight.
He does have like one ability that just one shots people, but
just run in the water if you're about to die. Just jump in the water.
Yeah.
Does that work for that one as well?
That's a general.
Can you jump in the water for that one?
Yeah.
That's what you did when you were like when you had your disconnect.
Oh right. Yeah. Okay.
You ran into the water.
Yeah, we did that dungeon. We got to the final boss my first time through, and we were about to kill him, and I disconnected.
It gives you no fucking XP. You get jack shit for rewards. You give it a fucking helm. And it looks fucking ugly.
I'm not gonna lie, it's kind of worth it because you get a lot of experience.
Yeah, early levels
every single time.
Early levels, yeah, you get 12k experience. I think it was some of that
At that level, yeah, that's a lot. Yeah.
Yeah.
I need 100,000 experience to level.
Yeah, you get like 12k experience, and then you get like 20 silver, I think, for finishing it.
Yeah, it's really nice.
No, I remember it was 13 silver because I remember being like,
I know, because there's also
4 silver for armor.
There's dynamic events along the way that give you. Well, I actually gained 30 silver from the entire thing because the dynamic events along the way give you a shitload of silver. And then
I lost quite a bit of money from armor.
Really? How many times did you die?
But that said,
I think I only spent like 5 silver.
Well, no, it's because I ran in there with no armor. Like,
oh, that's your own fault.
repaired. that's the game's fault. I should have like an automatic armor free, repair right? system. Yep. Mm-hmm. Who does it for free? For free. Totally.
They should just give you a console commands. Like that's what they should do.
Yeah, I paid for Digital Deluxe and only me. So I
a really good point is when you spawn into Ascalon Catacombs, just to the left of you is an anvil, and you can repair your armor there.
It's no longer. It no longer talks like a regular.
Yeah.
It used to talk like a regular armor repair smith, and it's like try not to break it.
But yeah. Now you can repair. You can't sell. That's, I would recommend emptying your inventory before you go into those.
How you give the anvil money? It's like a coin op machine. I'm assuming. Like.
I think suggesting that you repair your own armor on the anvil. It costs silver though. Yeah.
Yeah, but where? Why would I pay if I could just repair my own armor?
That's just my money back. Run of the dungeon. You get a bunch of XP, a bunch of silver, which is good for the level. But at higher levels, there's no real gain from doing story mode.
That helmet is fucking useless. Just throw it out. Just give it to me. I'll take it.
The light armor one was pretty good.
The medium armor has a nice skin, a really nice skin.
The heavy armor is fugly.
It's fucking shit.
Well, it's just a helmet. I would never. It's a
crappy
wear that helmet.
But yeah, like the actual. So how did you guys enjoy Ascalon Catacombs story? Like, did you guys think it was a good starting dungeon?
It was solid. Yeah,
it was a good dungeon.
Yeah, it was good. I feel like
Catacombs Manor has no replay value.
I feel like Catacombs Manor would have been a better introduction dungeon.
Agree.
Fantastic starting to that.
Totally
dungeon.
Agreed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Catacombs is a fun manor. It's a manor of fun. Catechus is fun house.
Well, I kind of want to stick to the same theme of we'll only do like, let's just say let's level 30 stuff today. And
we might definitely.
How
about we just bring this back every week and do a segment at the end? Or we might just do a dungeon episode where we go through the others. I felt that it was pretty. I think it was too difficult. Ascalon Catacombs for a first dungeon was too difficult, in my opinion.
I feel like
for a starter one, I think it was too difficult. That's part of the reason why I thought Catacombs. And again, I won't go into detail because we'll go into that later. But that's why I felt like that one would have been a better introduction one because it's more linear, and it's a lot more forgiving.
Yeah,
100% which is very important for starting out.
But it's like it feels nice because you go into Ascalon Catacombs at least in video game as a fat slob. You don't know how to fight. And then you get thrown into this dungeon, and it's like you learn to fight.
Yeah, that's true. It's a trial by fire.
You're still a fat slob in real life. It just you're no longer a fat slob in game.
It's definitely a trial by fire. Like it'll teach you things about your class and about how to play. There's definitely that element to it.
I just feel like a lot of people would maybe give up on dungeons with that being their first experience.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Like having something a bit easier, a bit more manageable first off, and then ramping up the difficulty.
And that's what the priory is for people who give up.
I would not have a problem if they did it the other way around, if they had a more forgiving one as the first one, and then just ramp it up drastically from the second one.
Yeah.
Well, especially because then, like, Catacombs Manor feels, like, kind of pointless after doing Ascalon Catacombs it's so easy and you've already been through there.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel tuned properly.
Yeah.
It's weird with the tuning because the Catacombs Manor in general is repeatable for very different reasons, let's just say, than Ascalon Catacombs because that one takes. Well, I won't go into it until next week, but that one is really nice to start off with and then kind of it peters off into difficulty. This one, it kind of starts difficult if you do it wrong.
Catacombs,
and then the traps fuck you over, and then the first boss, the ranger boss, keeps knocking you back. It's a piece of shit.
Imagine if they put explorable mode as like the main dungeon for beginners. How quickly will this
game? Would you guys recommend for someone to do this immediately at level 30? Like, would you just say when you hit level 30, do Ascalon Catacombs?
If you need an L2P, this is the best way to L2P.
I would say go ahead and do it at level 30. If you have friends to do it with, do not pug at level 30.
Oh, that's a good point. That is a very good point. If you're in a guild, definitely run it with your guild. it makes everything so much easier. And voice communications is awesome.
It's not necessary, but it's awesome
in this dungeon.
It's very, very helpful, especially if it's your first time going through it. Like, it's very, very helpful, especially if you have someone to help you through it. Like, if it's your first time, I'd honestly say if you could find someone who's done through who's gone through the dungeon, just like give you a little guidance.
Well, it's especially if you're running with Kessler, because then, I mean, you're basically formatting it. So,
because he's on the ground all the time,
and someone's taken all of your drops somehow. Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, somehow all the leather has disappeared out of your bags. You don't know how, but.
Another interesting point would be, I would suggest that you can start getting into build wars with this dungeon, in that you can start thinking about how your build contributes to the team. Because
by the way, you can switch your skills through the dungeon as long as you're not in combat,
important thing that I learned from doing this dungeon, and by extension, probably to a greater degree, the explorable, is that If you feel like you have all the skills that you need in PvE, don't just go randomly indiscriminately buying skills just because you have skill points. Hold on to them, because you may need to buy a skill for a dungeon.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Unless you're a warrior. I want to talk about class balance in a second.
Also, if you're an elementalist, get fire greatsword and always use it for dungeons.
Yeah, fire greatsword. Always be fire greatsword. Jesus Christ, that thing's so powerful. Anyway. What were we saying? Oh, yeah. So you get to start to think about how your build contributes to your team. Because up to that point in PvE, you're kind of just selfish. Like, I found that many times when I walk into Ascalon Catacombs and I ask what the team comp is, almost everyone is rolling pure DPS. Like, pretty much everyone, right? Literally 4 out of 5 people.
I ran out of stupid tanky builds.
Exactly. Like, first time I do Ascalon Catacombs, like, 3 out of 4 or 5 people are running pure deeps, and one person is running pure tank for some reason. And then there's me, obviously. I'm running balance, but
it was preparation.
Yeah, so like it's interesting that with this dungeon, especially with its relative high difficulty level, you have to start considering, like, okay, I'm elementalist. I'm used to staying in fire all the time. Maybe I should start thinking about, you know, switching to water and like I'm slowing the enemies down and healing my allies. That kind of stuff. Like,
yeah, pretty much as an elementalist, always stay in water, because that passive regen is amazing for everybody.
Yeah, it's just fantastic.
Like, and your damage isn't terrible.
For a thief, it's like, it'll feel like you're doing less because you're used to hitting for the big bucks in doing fire, but you're actually, in general, keeping the team alive and doing a better job in water some of the time.
So much more rewarding.
Yeah. That said, though, there's moments where you really need you to be in fire. Like, there's parts where you'll need to deeps. Just get burn an enemy down, and you can get in fire. Like, elementalist, I want to talk about all the classes, actually. So, elementalist, how do you guys feel you fared in Ascalon Catacombs story mode as an elementalist?
First off, I would recommend anybody going in, and this goes for any class, you know, beyond just elementalist, but always make sure you bring in a ranged option, and water attunement doesn't count.
Yeah.
It doesn't quite hit far enough, but you want to make sure you have a ranged, so, you know, either bring a scepter or staff in there. Mm-hmm. But overall, in Ascalon Catacombs, I definitely felt like I spent a lot more time in water than I had in the past. And that was actually probably really good, because that's probably like my third attunement in terms of like how much time I spend in it. Mm-hmm. Earth, I pretty much never go into ever.
Yeah.
They need to do some work to Earth, I think, but that's a different podcast.
Well, it's Sookee.
Work it, baby.
Sookee, what are your feelings on that? About the same thing?
Well, I've been only running with staff. Like,
staff
just
is
staff.
Awesome.
I haven't run anything else. And for the story mode, I think it's you can basically do whatever. Just make sure that you don't die. That's pretty much how I feel about story mode.
Mm-hmm.
In expo mode, I would suggest to probably go with staff, because you'll just get fucked.
Don't just fucking run in without discussing your build with your teammates.
We've been doing that a lot.
Expo mode in a second, because just like a preview of it, rather than going deep into it, because I don't have enough time, to be honest. But
let's just discuss our run real quick. Like, what the hell?
Beyond that, I'd say Guardians. I've actually done Ascalon Catacombs through my 4 runs with every class now, and I can say that every class is perfectly fine for the story.
It's totally viable.
Totally viable. 100% viable. But the main thing is you cannot spec... Well, in most cases, you should not spec purely into deeps. That's my main thing. It's more about your build than your class. That's what we found.
Man, deeps is a fucking weird word. Just say DPS.
It's a fine DPS. So like the people who spec balanced
damage per second.
The people who spec balanced or what's his face? The survivability generally do significantly better than the people who spec pure damage. Like just if you're finding that your trait lines are mainly power precision trait lines, and your gear is all power and precision stuff, that works perfectly fine for PvE, but you'll get one shot or two shot unless you're like really, because Dourin did that as well, but he's been PvP trained to some extent. Like this is not his first time around the rink. Like he's done this kind of stuff before, like difficult stuff. And you know he guys his dodges down. Like he knows what to do there. But if it's your first time in a dungeon, if you've done any PvP before, you're not used to like looking for enemy tails, you're looking for dodging out of the way. Running pure deeps is a sure way to get destroyed, really, in Ascalon Catacombs.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And even then, like there were a lot of times where I still was swapping over to staff just because it would keep me alive.
Yeah. There you go. So that's story mode. Have fun with that. I definitely would personally recommend everyone do it as well. But that's because
it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, and well, for me, I didn't expect to enjoy it. And look at me now. I'm just literally running every dungeon, every permutation, every dungeon. It is so fun. So let's talk about explorer mode, guys. Hey guys. Hey.
Oh, fuck.
Hey.
So I was telling a friend actually while we were doing it, I was like, you know, who needs raiding in an MMO when you have Guild Wars 2 explorable mode dungeons?
Thank you. Yes.
Because this exactly brings what I've been way saying. More difficulty and challenge and teamwork than at anything I've ever done in a raid.
Yeah.
So true. Signed. I'm offline.
Because you two have done a bunch of... Wow. So how would you guys... Cause this is a question I always ask. And a question I asked on Mumble as well. But let's start with Sookee. How do you feel about this versus the difficulty of stuff in WoW?
We've talked about this yeah. quite a lot. I feel very much reminded of heroic raiding content.
Pre-nerf, I think you said.
Well, yeah, whatever. It's hard to talk about it because stuff just constantly changes in WoW.
Yeah.
But I generally just take the general heroic content, raiding content, like tier content, and when it like comes out, and I feel that could kind of match the difficulty to what we see in Guild Wars 2 right now.
Dourin?
With the expo mode.
What would you think?
Well, by the time they started introducing like a lot of the heroic mode stuff, I kind of had tapped out of raiding.
Right.
But so I can't really speak to that necessarily. But like what they're doing in Guild Wars 2 is kind of what I've wanted them to do in WoW for some time, and that is like drop the number from these ridiculous like 25 and even to some extent the 10 man stuff. Drop it down to something more manageable, like the 5 man groups that we're doing here. And with that you can get some really interesting boss encounters and some really good challenge, and even more importantly, really tight teamwork required to do these things.
Oh yeah. Absolutely. Because
and that makes it a lot more fun. Like you do a 25 man raid in WoW, you can lose 5 or 6 people and it's not really a big deal. You're not gonna feel it. You do a 10 man, you can lose 1 or 2 people and you're not gonna really feel it. In this one, like, everybody matters. If somebody goes down, you better get his ass up. Or if he goes down for good, he better run his ass back as fast as he can. Because yeah. everybody is feeling that.
I don't know. I'd show it that dungeon.
Fuck you.
I mean, I basically
to put things in perspective, you know all that stuff we said about the story mode? Forget all that. Just forget all that. It's explorer mode.
Forget
is
about
nothing
it.
Like story mode. It is some of the same maps, like you see some of the same surroundings, but nothing's the same.
Basically, the story mode is a portion of the explorable mode filled in with really easy shit, yet it's still
it's,
fucking
it's really
painful.
Just like, but it's still they really just yeah. created one big dungeon and then they split it in 4 different parts.
Yeah.
And so one is the story one, and then the 3 expo modes, they just kind of take different
yeah,
paths.
You're like, all right, I did Ascalon Catacombs. I feel like I could take on the world. 4 hours later, you'll be cursing your existence. Why do That's I really exist?
And that was just the first boss.
For us, right, I've done it all three ways. I've done it with entirely different comps of people.
Damn right, you've done it all three ways.
I can say that first time through the dungeon on explorable mode, with an organized group of people who aren't shit at the game, takes 4 hours. 4 hours per run. Mm-hmm. Every single run I've done has taken 4 hours.
It's different. It's fucking different, yeah. Too.
Jesus Christ. So,
hey there, Guild Wars 2 player. Want to be fucking angry for 4 hours? Come play explorable mode. They must hate their fucking fans. This is a great way to troll them.
So, what level did you guys do Ascalon Catacombs Explorer mode in first? I was 37 when I first did one.
Dourin? I think I was 37.
I was 59.
That was me last night, right?
I think I was also 37.
Was
that it?
That was today for me.
Dourin?
I don't remember.
I think I was also 37.
Yeah, and Sookee, I'm not sure, but you're higher level than the rest of us when we started running those. I guess you're around 30. But I'd say that that's a good time to do it. You don't need, because all the dungeons scale you to their level. You don't need to be level 60 to do the explorer mode dungeon. Like, you can do it at level 37 or 38, 40. And still get through it.
I think the reason ArenaNet suggests 60 for the explorables is just because by that point you've gotten so much experience in the game, and experience with your class and with things like dodging and seeing attacks and just general better feel for the game. That by the time you hit 60,
nothing to do with your traits. Absolutely not. That regardless of if you had that trait or not, if you take that hit, you're probably dead anyway.
Yeah.
You dodge it or you're dead.
A couple moments yesterday.
It's not
even new.
You put up Aegis or you're dead.
Add duty for a couple of it. And by add duty, we mean aggroing, so attacking a bunch of enemies at the same time and just fucking running for your life.
And fucking running around.
And just running for your life. Just trying to keep them on you as opposed to attacking something you're trying to protect. Because he's a guardian and he had some decent survivability to him. You respect deeps, right? But not entirely deeps. Balance more like?
No. I was spec deeps, but I was also very health heavy and it's toughness and damage was basically.
Yeah, so you were pretty much balanced. You're at what I would call a balanced build, and I was a balanced build as well. It depends on the situation, but
Targaryen went basically
full tank. And we, no matter who he was, if you started taking damage, you died. You had to avoid taking damage. In case of
all damage,
What would happen? It's especially with those. Should we explain the zone first?
Should we go into? Do you think we have enough time to go through one type of run? Or, I don't think we have time. I don't think
do
we
have time. Do we ever have
guys,
time for
it's 7 a.m. Yeah. here. I don't
exactly.
know.
Oh, God. We should not go into it. But right, let's just say that there's always a protection mission. And in that case,
where you have to protect this piece of fucking shit.
Oh, yeah. the most worthless NPC ever.
In all versions.
Just in general.
Every version, they're always the fucking worst. And
if human society could leap hundreds of thousands of years ahead by killing one person, it would be this person in this dungeon.
And
it's just the most putrid human scum I've seen in my life. And there's a fucking video.
So I just want to let you guys, as the audience, know that there'll be a protection section, and you will hate every dungeon, every run of Ascalon Catacombs Explorer mode has a lead up to boss, a couple bosses, and then a room which is the worst thing you'll have ever done in a video game for about two hours or so. You'll be on that room, and then you'll beat that room, and you'll feel amazing, and then the rest of the dungeon's relatively not too bad. It's all relatively doable.
Well, but relatively not too bad, except for that last boss who just
instant KO.
You feel real good. You feel real good after what you've done, and then you get to him, and he just fucking reminds you that you're just dirt. You were just trash.
We found how to probably do ours.
You did Colossus Rumbus with me, right, Dourin? Was that the one we did?
Yeah. Yeah, I did Rumbus, yeah.
Yeah, so the other one, what's his face? The Scepter one, the human path, has a boss that opens the fight in the same way. Let's just say to the audience, I don't want to spoil it to you. Watch how the boss opens the fight. That's what I'm going to say. Because when you're fighting the final boss in those two paths, so not the Charr one, because that boss fight is pretty easy, but the other two, when he walks up to you, just watch what he does. Just make sure you're keeping your eye on it. and have fun.
The other thing I was
isn't halfway through its pregnancy and it fucking shits babies all over.
The other thing I will say is the on the protection one.
Yep.
At least for the one that we did, I can't speak for the other ones. It sounds like they're the same though.
Yep.
Trust us, they can be completed. Yep. You may not think so doing it.
You may think
that it's just broken.
That's a really good point. They are totally
but it can be done.
Balanced. Like it I did not.
Oh, no, they're not balanced.
Well, they're not balanced.
They're tight.
They're balanced on a very fine fucking line.
They're
balanced.
Yeah.
You have to do it just right for all three of them, and you can get through it. And it doesn't matter what your level is. It doesn't matter what classes you have with you. You just have to get the right people doing the right job at the right time and get your timings down, and you get through that room.
It's really easier just to throw out your game. It's
so much easier.
And expect that one room to take you an hour
and you save so much time.
What this has showed me is that like at people, you know, people doing the dungeons, I think the story mode is pretty much kind of for everybody.
Yeah.
These explorable modes, these are not going to be for everybody. These are not going to, like, this has me a little worried about kind of the, what is supposed to be the end game of Guild Wars 2, because I felt like,
it's going to be speed clearing these dungeons for those fucking tiers.
Well, I felt like PvE or PvE wise, like, this was supposed to be the end game. This is what everyone does when they hit level 80.
Yeah.
But after going through and doing some of the explorables, not everybody is going to go through these and actually finish them.
Mm-hmm.
Like these are just they are tuned very, very difficult. And I hope that they don't. I hope they don't nerf them.
Yeah,
but it makes me worry. Like, what other content there will be for the people who maybe can't do this stuff?
You know what exactly? What exactly these dungeons are for? It's so people can get speed clear builds and finish these an hour every day. Like, and do that like five times a day and earn money. This is like speed clear. That's it. This is what
because I can say that when you get the entire. Dungeon is pretty simple. For all of it, story mode, explorer mode, when you have the general idea, when you've done it once, it's much easier the second time through.
There's going to be specific builds for it. There's going to be like specific paths.
Yeah.
Specific
and
splits.
So when you
once
get
that's figured out,
the
it's literally
inverted
a split
second room
builds.
Is what I call it. Like the protection room. When you get that down, it's easy from there on. Like you just have, it's just about execution. Like when you have the idea of how to
time
get it down,
time is split in half. It's
yeah,
split
then,
in half.
Then you're good.
I wouldn't call it easy, but it's
yeah, it's doable.
Well
it's doable.
Yeah,
you will be able to repeat it
once. Like having done enough speed clears in the original Guild Wars, and it feels very much the same way. The first time is going to be a bitch when you're figuring out stuff, but around like the 80th or the 90th time, you're going to figure it out.
Oh, I did the math on it. So
I'm going
to
be there.
When you complete these dungeons, I want to talk about the drops, and we'll end out the show. You don't get much stuff, do you?
No, you don't get anything.
They say, hey, come back and waste 50 more hours for the rest of the year doing this dungeon. And you can get these video game tiers that you can buy.
So,
they're actually your tiers. They're actually the tiers of your character after having run the place.
No, they're
so,
my real life tiers.
The dungeon itself in explorer mode doesn't give you much in the way of drops, and it doesn't give you much in the way of XP. Like literally, this is the slowest way to level in the entire game because I've been stationary at like level 50-ish for so long because I've been doing these dungeons and loving them, but I'm not getting levels and not even getting gear. Like you don't get shit.
By the way, when I was level 59. And I did the entire dungeon. I got more XP from doing 1.5 dynamic events than I did in that 4 hours of that dungeon. And that took me like
20 minutes. Yeah.
Don't come there for XP. You're in the wrong place.
You'd be crazy.
You're miles away. You
and don't come there for loot.
I
bet you got better, more gold from those two dynamic events and more loot.
What do you mean? I don't think I got a green except at the very end chest.
Really? We had pretty good luck with our
run. If you wanted loot, you'd have fucking better chance finding it in a different game.
So
finding loot for Guild Wars 2.
Why would you want to go there?
So the reason you'd go there are for... Thank you, Sookee, for that transition. The reason you'd want to go there is for a item you get from each of the dungeons, explorable mode, called X tiers. I think they all call something tiers, right?
Ascalonian.
Well, they all have an item that you get, like a yellow item, which is soulbound, so you can't trade it.
You're like, so at the end of each area, like, so there's three areas basically. So one protection, one something, and then one boss fight. And then, so you're like, you get 15 of them.
You get 30.
15 or 10?
It's 10
or
at the end.
So you get 30, and you're like, holy shit, I get 30 of these. I only need to do one run. Tough shit. Because
so you
you're
get
gonna
this
have
unique
to do
item,
these for hours on
5
end.
For the first boss, I think it's 10 for the second thing, and then 15 for completing the dungeon. So in total, you get 30 to run. And what you do is you go to Lion's Arch. There's the portals for War vs. Worlds.
Ryan's Arch.
The portal for War vs. Worlds, there's a bunch of NPCs there who trade you the endgame armor, the unique armors associated for that dungeon and weapons associated for that dungeon for these collectible items.
It's in Fort Mariner.
Yeah, it's at Fort Mariner, yeah. So the numbers you're looking at here is you get 30 tiers for a run. And to get a complete set, I think I did a math on this. I'm not sure if math is accurate, but these numbers are around about right. To get a complete set of armor representative of the dungeon using those unique items, you're looking at about 50 runs of that dungeon.
50 runs. You're like, man, I got like 90 of these. Why would I ever need to do this again?
Nope.
I would like to
50
add
go ahead.
Runs.
When after we finished Caucasus Manor explorer mode, we only got 25.
Oh Jesus Christ!
So I can see them actually going down or
hey,
up
you.
Or just varying.
That's right, you. Fuck you. That's exactly what ArenaNet just said to you. It's like
so
you finished this. You're like, congratulations.
The last thing
I want to
talk about today is how do you guys feel about this? We already touched on it earlier, but I kind of want to go to it again. How do you guys feel about this? Are you guys going to do explorable modes more, or do you think you're going to be in this end game? Like, what are you guys' thoughts? Dourin?
I think I'm going to do them more. I think it's a lot of fun. It's going to be hard, I think, when I go back to work. Because they do take so long, so it'll probably be like maybe I'll do one on a weekend or something.
Yeah, one pre
but
weekend
I do like I yeah, but I do like the difficulty of them. Again, though, it has me kind of worried as to like what end game PvE is going to be for this game for people who maybe aren't quite as hardcore into this stuff.
Yeah, like straight up. But it's kind of interesting. Are the people who aren't as hardcore also going to be the people who care about the end game?
If WoW has showed me anything, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
They absolutely changed their entire end game because of those people.
Right.
Yeah.
So what you say is we'll have to see how the end game dynamic events and stuff are before we know what's there for those people, or would you say that they're kind
of
screwed?
Right. I want to see more of ore before.
Yeah. Exactly. Like, see what the end game ore stuff is. Like, more so like what people are going to get out of that. Like, it's not a matter of just that it's easier so they can go do it. Like, if there's not rewards that are comparable to doing the explorable dungeons, they're still going to be pissy about it.
Dude, I can't believe that the loot is scaled this way. I just cannot believe it doesn't give you amazing loot.
I mean, I can see why. It does. Because as a person who's fucking pissed away about maybe 500 hours of my life doing one single speed clear for these faction points, which literally give you nothing.
In Fescue Wars.
I can for once say I will be pissing away my time. And this is like when you're doing these speed clears, you literally can't be doing anything other than focusing on the speed clears, because like even if you've done them 100 times, you still need to be like focusing. And if you're doing other stuff while doing it, you're going to get fucked. So have fun if you're going to go my route. On not having
I might fun, not. I probably won't be there with do. You. I did not think I'd love the dungeons in Guild Wars 2. I'm a person who likes Dark Souls. I'm a person who likes difficult fucking games. I when other people are giving up, I'm going, fuck yeah, this is awesome. I can't wait till we beat this room. Like, all three runs I did of AC Explorer mode, every single time, even me once, like the first time we did it for Ghost Eater, I was just like, dude, I'd rather restart this dungeon than keep doing this fucking room because this is impossible. But if you push past the protection room, it is the most wondrous feeling, and you just feel like you've done something. You've achieved something.
When we finished that room in the explorable mode, like everyone like cheering over Mumble because we finished it. Like that was reminiscent to me of back in the days whenever I did the raiding in WoW and we were doing progression and took down a boss for the first time. Like it was that same feeling.
Yep. Yeah. And
it's so cool. Like as somebody who can't raid anymore and can't have that kind of a commitment, like to be able to still have that feeling again in an MMO.
You know what's the best feeling is when that dilutes down to fucking nothing after you've done it 90 times, and then people are going, I can't believe you fucked that up. That cost us five minutes on this run.
Fuck those guys.
And people are yelling at each other, and
that is the true enjoyment of friends.
That
in our guild, we don't have people like that. So you're the most likely to be that person to use that jerk in the guild. And I'm never going to do a run with you.
That's right. If you want to enjoy the way of me and not enjoy the game, which is how you enjoy the game,
I don't know what I'm talking about.
That just messed with my mind.
Let's do it.
Also, another pro tip would be, especially with the one we did this morning, Your Time Noob, look for alternative ways to achieve your goals.
We twist our strategy.
The protection room is, there's only one way to do it that I've seen. Like, there's literally one perfect way that you can do it. Every time I've seen one of those protection rooms, obviously that varies on your comp. Like the way varies on your composition of people, but you'll find the way that works for your group eventually, and you'll get through the room. But for everything past that, there's usually an alternative way of approaching situations. Like we literally avoided
that boss fight,
an hour long segment, and did it in like 5 minutes by doing an alternate way, and we beat the final boss on a second try. By doing an alternate way. Like, literally, there's other ways of doing things. So that's my last little note there.
Yeah, I told you that thing led to a waypoint. It was a waypoint out of Ascalon Catacombs. Is exactly what that was.
So, yeah, I love them. Snooki loves them. Noob, are you gonna be doing these again? Would you be interested in doing the other Ascalon Catacombs?
I will be doing these 100 times over and over again. Yeah, yes.
That's crazy. Well, do you want to do the a different path today?
Whether or not I will enjoy them. I enjoyed it the first run through. It felt its length, but the problem was, like, I don't know. I can hate segments of a game, but if I have to do it, I will do it.
I can say right here that I'll probably be not doing AC Explorable Mode anymore unless someone needs me to complete that team. Because for me, it's the doing it the first time that I love the most. Like, once you get that thing down, once you beat that thing, that's what I'm here for. So, yeah, if you need me to complete your team, I'll
Right, but what about the robotic repetition where the fun of the game no longer exists because you are just a slave to your own game?
That's how I feel, too. I don't think I'll be doing it before I hit 80 again.
Yeah.
Or somebody really needs
us. But you have one more run to do, right?
I do, yeah. Yes.
So, but you'll be willing to do that? Others?
Yeah, I intend to do all variants. Explo paths, but probably not more than once before I actually have to do them again.
If Shinboy is a speed clear guy, I'll be just sitting there with him, depressed.
And with that, we can end out the show. Like, you scum. 4 hours. So,
good lord.
Oh, so thank you for listening to the Lincolncast. Dourin, do you have any plugs?
Not really, no. I've been plugging my channel, and I haven't been streaming, even though I should be, so.
All right. Nibarama, do you have any plugs?
I'd like to plug the PC Gaming Hub. I haven't been doing stuff that much recently, but CSGO will be on Sunday. It's probably not going to be up by Sunday, but whatever. So we're playing a bunch of different games. It's mostly like fucking stupid games, but they're really fun to play with other people. So just hop on our mobile server. Cynic, could you plug that?
Yep.
It's a good way to meet other giant bomb duders.
Are you going to be...
Oh, and
are you still the greatest cooking
me.
Cheerio, or are you giving up on that?
Fuck that, I'm never going to
never going to give up. Oh, because you've been...
I was the first one to hit 50
and
100.
And then you just got fucking dominated by some people in that guild.
Shinboy's not doing it for the joy
of cooking.
He's doing it
to beat you.
He's doing
it
for the joy of leveling. He's just a scum. Not Shinboy.
Oh, the other
What's
guy.
His name?
Sandante, yeah. He's just Dante. Doing it to beat you. I love him. I love him so much.
Scum.
The
cooking gods will strike
Snooki,
you down.
Do you have any of the plug? I don't know. Do you have any of the plug?
I don't even know what that means. So,
like
a
just
website,
like link
a blog,
something
of
a blog or a plug.
Yeah, no, a plug. As
well,
in like,
a plug,
either way,
underground Stasi movement.
Either way, I don't have one. I have Facebook, but I don't think that's what you're asking for.
I have Facebook. Who are you, me?
So join the Gestapo.
No, I should do that right now. Gestapo. No, not the Gestapo. They don't.
Please don't end the show on me being like part of some kind of Nazi organization.
It's not Nazi. It's Stasi. Basically, what the Stasi
I have to
would
say, take
do
this
is
opportunity
instead of just
to officially
torture.
Apologize for the Lincolncast. If you're German out there,
or if you're Jewish, because apparently those
yeah,
guys
some of that, some
tough
shit like that
at the beginning
know,
of this
some,
podcast
happened in past.
Stop that. Stop it.
Or if you're in the Stasi or the SS, and
stop
I
it.
You, by all means, I'm sorry.
Not existing
Thank
anymore.
Thank you for listening, and goodbye.
That's what you think.